We're rolling, brother.
Are you on?
Thanks for taking the time. It's been a long time, man, trying to track you down.
Trying to track me down.
Well, I mean, I want to introduce you as the most hated politician in Niagara. I don't want to offend you, though, man.
More than Donald Trump?
Well, I mean, you're making the most news for sure. So if I'm going to talk to someone, I want to talk to the guy that's making the most news and the guy that's the most controversial. So, well, thanks for taking the time.
No problem, Jim.
You need no introduction, but I'll introduce you anyways. Andy Petrowski. So, man, we've had...
Second-term regional councillor.
Yeah.
Right? Don't forget that.
Yeah.
1 year to go. Nudge, nudge, wig, wig.
Now, I know everyone... Well, not everyone. For me, this integrity commissioner has been a long haul.
Amen.
I mean, we went through this governance conversation started by St. Catharines. You know, this double direct thing. And at first, you know, I want to take credit for being the guy that says, hey, good on you, Walter, for trying to slide one through when he tried to get the test pilot. You know, anytime you can go to the province and get some of our sovereignty back and some of our power back, I'm a fan of it. And I thought it was kind of slippery being a neophyte newly elected that he was going to take a route like that and just try and slide it through. So I like the idea. But at the first, the double direct, I didn't really know where I fell on it. But then as I looked at it, it's not going to save any money. Centralizing power is no good. And this idea that we've got too many elected politicians.
According to you.
Yeah, well, I mean, anytime you centralize the power and take it further away from the people that actually, where the issues lie, I think that we can do, I'd rather see the region abolished. But, you know, going back
it's
to.
It's doing a good job on its own, isn't it?
Yeah, well, some people are, a lot of people are really frustrated by it. So.
The dual direct, though, I think Walter, though, had a kind of obligation to bring it in because he was general manager of the Commerce Court people.
What's and he campaigned on it for sure.
What do they call them? The Chamber of Commerce. Yeah. He campaigned on it. So I guess he thought it would work. But I don't think the title suited it properly, and that was confusing. Double direct. I like the title dual role.
Right.
So you're wearing two hats. You're a municipal councillor. And you're a regional councillor, and that model works. And, of course, the nonsensical notion is that it's going to help improve communications.
Right.
So, no, I think it could work if the City of St. Catharines Council shrunk down to six councillors, right? I don't even know if we need ward councillors, but I guess if you went to a ward councillor, it'd certainly be cheaper to run. It's highly unfair right now that we have regional councillors who have to run across the city like me with folks who are running for mayor. They pay regional councillors all of about $25,000 net a year, which is grossly underpaid compared to what our
other... And it speaks to the type of candidate that you can attract or recruit to with that type of compensation. We all know where that box that we're...
Well, that's purposeful. Hmm. Attract councillors who... don't particularly want to come to the position in a full-time capacity and serve, even though the job requires full-time. There's right. No question about it. I mean, why in Hamilton, Jim, everywhere around the horseshoe, from here to Oshawa, there are full-time counselors. Mm-hmm. So Hamilton, Halton, Peel, York, Durham, Toronto, and you got to ask yourself, so why are they keeping the region part-time? Well, there's probably two reasons. Number one, we have way too many councillors. I mean, at the region, we have those 12 mayors who are there.
And they've always made the point of taking the mayors off council, and they're already duly elected double role councillors.
But they're not duly elected.
No, they're not. You're right.
Nobody's
they're
voting not, for them. You're voting for a mayor.
Regional council. Yeah.
You're voting for a mayor, and then you end up with supposedly somebody who's going to represent the interests of the region. The fact is, every mayor up there, not one of them,
and they're not shy about saying, I'm here for my own backyard. I'm here for my city.
Yeah, Joyner said it publicly. I remember Barry Sharp came out and said it. Redicop said it. They all know it. They're there. They're there getting the exact same pay as a regional councillor like myself. There's 18 of us. They have no obligation to sit on any more committees than one standing committee. So some of us, like me last term, sat on 12, 13, 14 committees, exact same pay. Hmm. Now, right off the bat, how's that
fair?
Well,
you don't get a stipend or an adjustment for sitting on committees?
No. You have to sit on, mayors have to, no, the obligation of a regional councillor, which the mayors effectively call themselves at the region, is that they sit on one standing committee. Okay. And same for the regional councillors. So some of these folks, and some of the regional councillors, park themselves on one committee, knowing, I guess, that, you know, why sit on more committees?
So why is a guy like you who, you know, struggles financially as being, you know, independently employed?
Well, you struggle if you make the focus the region. So you, it's hard to juggle two things. How would you carry, first of all?
Why 12 committees, though? Why wouldn't you be out on the road banging business instead of sitting in committees?
100%. You have to do that. No. If you make a decision to attend 12 committees, you better be self-employed and better be prepared to see your T4 slip drop by 80%.
But why? Just to be connected, just to find out what's going on? Like,
what's the incentive
for you to sit on all these committees?
Nothing.
So why do you do it then?
I did it last term. Okay. I really pared down this term. You have to. No, but the reality is, ask why would you need to sit on the committees? Because if you don't sit on the committees where all the deeds are done and the sins are committed and the sins are exposed, by the time it gets to council, Jim, nobody's paying attention.
Right.
Council is basically ratifying the...
They're barely reading the committee reports that come in their package.
Standing committees of minutes of that previous week or previous 2 weeks reports ratified, and just at last council I attended, we have public works come up. Nobody stands up on anything. And yet, the assumption that Jim Fannons of the world and the lovely people of Niagara are all tuned in to the committee meetings online? Hardly. They could probably not stay awake watching council. So by the time it gets to council, you have this conglomeration of reports from each standing committee with the hope that when the guy stands up or the lady stands up and reads the synopsis of the minutes, you know, they always do that for about 2 seconds.
Mm-hmm.
And we have a call from the chair, all in favor of the minutes. Unless there's something really contentious and they're trying to jam through a $10 million track and field stadium, people ratify it. Because of my council ban from committees right now, pending this sensitivity training, or I guess this brainwashing indoctrination without definition around it, we can talk about that.
Well, they want to adjust your unconscious biases. So even if you don't know you're a racist, homophobic bigot, they will get to you and make sure that they indoctrinate you into their way of thinking.
But their way of thinking is Kathleen Wynne's way of thinking and Justin Trudeau's way of thinking. This is all parochial and it's all nonsense. It's as long as I talk like Kathleen Wynne and I talk like Justin Trudeau, it's fine, and I can be called inclusive. But if I decide to take another streak and go the conservative route and hold as per my democratic rights to other values, then I'm not inclusive, and I'm a bigot, and I'm a homophobe, and I'm a racist, and I'm a xenophobe. This identity politics thing is just getting so nonsensical. And the fact that it's even at the region, the bottom line is the taxpayer is getting ripped off. They're getting ripped off. And I'm not talking about the expenses issue. That's another issue. They're getting ripped off even in their understanding of that. But they're getting ripped off because we're slicing and dicing through these things, and there's just very limited political will, I believe, to really bite into the teeth of the business of the region. And
Amen.
Going right back to that pay thing, without councillors buried at the committee level and trying to get things done and having a concern, and as Peter Cormos, my seatmate last term, used to say, you might not always win, but shining the light on these things. Mm. Who's shining the light on these, Jim? Like, honestly, who's shining the light on?
Not too many guys.
And when we do, thank you for the opportunity here, we don't have a responsible media, except I've been calling them out. I call out CKTB, I call out The Standard, I call them fake news only because that's a convenient term, but it's not even fake, it's dishonest news. It's dishonest because they're
It's selective, at the very least.
No, it's dishonest because they knowingly are avoiding reporting in somewhat of a thorough and consistent fashion on the media issues of the region. I call it dishonest. I mean, when you hear these radio announcers or you read the garbage in the birdcage liner, otherwise known as the fish wrapper, the Standard, when you're reading this stuff and you know, for the first time, I guess, maybe because they're feeling a tinge of guilt, we saw a story on Public Works and the shortfall. Mm-hmm. But everything they write is has an agenda. Nothing to do with news. Their agenda is to make certain people and certain situations look bad.
Mm-hmm.
End of the day. I mean, that's the MO for
some. They don't have to stretch that far, but then they just tweak it a little bit and it makes a huge difference. But let's get back to this huge waste of time. First, we had this governance talk, which to me, and
you mean the double direct.
Yes.
Right. Which became parochial because at the end of the day, the vote was shaped around those councillors on our regional council who voted against it, Jim. Didn't want to lose their job.
Mm.
And knowing probably that, and that would be coming more from the newer ones, because the newer you are, as I was a first term, I still had to spend $20,000-$25,000 the second term just to reacquaint the electorate.
So you broke even with your pay.
First year.
First year.
Good return, huh?
Yeah.
Run the same campaign as a mayor does. Mayor pretty well gets all his or her financing covered by fundraising, right? Mm-hmm. You know, let's face it, because it's a more higher profile campaign. And they're making, you know, Walter's making some 100, 120 as a mayor, plus his region pay. And then you ask the regional councillors to run in that citywide kind of campaign to get any kind of public exposure. You got to spend, you can't win unless you spend money. I've had people tell me, oh, I want to run. The one exception that I'm not even going to give that person credit for is when the paper can do some gratuitous coverage of some counselors mm-hmm. because they have maybe some special relationships with people there, or their friends have special relationships, right. And then maybe you get on. But
so all the while we're talking about governance, which my take was, and again, I don't want to pat myself on the back too much, but I was on 12,
you were for it,
I was on 12 agendas to speak against the dual direct.
Okay. Because you finally turned against it, right?
Yeah, I didn't want to see the centralization of power. I didn't want to see the reduction of accessibility. I didn't believe in the communication strategy that it was going to be more, we're going to communicate better with the multiple levels of government. I mean, we don't have very many regions where there's two-tier governments in Ontario. I think there's only three, is there? Like St. Catharines and a couple others.
Well,
anyways, I put myself on 12 agendas as soon as it came. As soon as the region rubber stamped it. Okay, so it comes from St. Catharines. They get the green light. It goes to the region. They rubber stamp it. They give the green light back to St. Catharines. Well, where does it go first? First, it goes to St. Catharines. So that's where I spoke first.
Right.
And I wasn't alone. There was other people there for and against it. I think there was 12 presenters.
No, where'd you speak? At the open air gymnasium meeting in the PAC?
No, it was in council. Yeah, council chambers in St. Catharines. Of which,
well, because they were forced to do that. Remember?
Oh, were they?
They started off with that PAC night. Were you at the PAC night?
Oh,
let's just have a fireside coffee chat, and I don't know who the favorite moderator...
George Dart.
Who the favorite paid moderator was or not.
He wasn't down with that, how they tried to appease him there.
But we kept throwing it back at council. It wasn't done right.
It comes back to St. Catharines for the first of 12 for the double majority, or the triple majority, right?
For the actual vote night, you mean?
Yeah, things like no smoking in a public park passes the triple majority with no problems.
Right.
Okay? Something like double direct, I was hell-bent that it was not going to pass, and I would speak at every council and give them the same speech, and so we killed it in St. Catharines.
By the way, Canada Dry. By the way, just for your radio.
You're not a drinker anyways, are you?
No. I've enjoyed being, if I say that to the wine community, I've enjoyed being not having to have a sip of alcohol in the last almost 3 months.
Yeah, are you a kind of guy that could ever blame anything that you've done that's been out of the ordinary on booze?
No, I just think it's more healthy. It's more in line with my faith kind of commitments.
Alcohol is evil. anyway, so getting back to the DDD, the DD double director, governance. So this governance thing has been manifesting since the St. Catharines Chamber of Commerce changed its name to the Greater Niagara Chamber of Commerce when it's really not greater anything. In fact, I think Thorold pulled out. Did they not pull out?
Who knows? The membership fee might be greater.
Yeah, they might have
and their payroll is greater.
If they had taken Niagara Falls and Welland with them, at least the two biggest cities, the two other biggest cities other than St. Catharines, then I would have, given them a partial pass. But then it really put Mayor Senzik in a predicament, because when it came back to St. Catharines and he lost that, now he's a lame duck mayor. Like, he doesn't have a council that will support him on just about anything now, because in my mind, the lines have been drawn, right? So anytime those lines are really going to line up the same way, and we can talk about, the Liberals versus the Conservatives, and we all know that
and the NDP.
The last few terms, and the NDP, but the NDP's never had power from the chair's office,
right.
And has never had a majority of people at council either. So right. usually the NDP is the spoiler,
right.
And you get the Conservatives and Liberals going at it. The point I'm making to come all the way back to this again is how much time did we spend on reports and debating a thing that I predicted in the very beginning would never pass the triple majority. And I was, like I said, I put myself on 12 agendas to make sure it didn't happen, and then had to remove myself from 12 agendas or 11 more agendas after it died in St. Catharines. Brings me to the integrity commissioner, the whole code of conduct.
But backing up, Jim, it's important. Like, I think that whole double direct, the mayor was in a box not to. If he hadn't done it, then his chamber people would be saying, you know, he kind of ran somewhat on chamber.
I don't know. No. I think that's legacy. I think that's ego. He's like, I'm going to change the system. And if I never do another term after this, I can point to.
My point is, though, I don't think it was important what the outcome was going to be. Just get it on the floor.
Mm.
So, and I mean, I don't recall last term.
Oh, I think the outcome was, I think he was married to the outcome because he was not happy when that thing didn't go down.
Yeah.
And you could hear it in his voice in his media interviews afterwards. Is governance dead? Is the governance issue dead at St. Catharines in the region? Yeah, I can say that won't come back again this term. And I'm glad because I don't want to see the centralization of power.
Well, you're just one voice, though. Mm-hmm. And that's why last term I tried to have a referendum with about 7-8 questions on. Mm-hmm. And first pass the council, of course, because all the enemies of Petrowski won't want any.
So is that just it? Like, how does something as simple as taking the pulse of the community in a non-binding plebiscite or referendum, right. How does anyone say, you know, I don't really think I want to know what my constituents think. I don't know what the population of each ward or each town or each city, I don't care what they think. Like, how could anyone be against referendum?
We had seasoned councillors from outside of St. Catharines. I'm not going to name them. Work on multi-term counselors. One person, she said, basically, I'm not sure that the constituents would understand these questions.
Oh, yeah. They're ignorant.
Yeah, like nothing like, that's the Hillary Clinton deplorables. Mm. You're a deplorable. So all I was saying, so I had 7 questions or 8 questions. It got weaned down to 2. And then the 2 got stripped off. And it didn't get stripped off. They made sense. They were about term limits,
mm-hmm.
dual direct, transit, all sorts of, you know, pretty.
Sound like a candidate for the None of the Above party now.
but Jim, just get the, just, you said the pulse, get people
referenda,
to respond. Hey, you know what? I think actually that would be a media draw to go out and vote. You're saying, hey, you might not know whether Petrowski's running again, whether you want to vote for him or not. You don't really, you're not probably to engage in what the region's doing on and off every day other than the stupidity reported by the local media. But you have a chance now to vote on things like, do you think your councillor should be there 85 terms like some of them have seemed to have been?
40 years.
And one of them was the double direct. Mm. And maybe they not necessarily understood all the things like you talk about centralization, Jim, but why not at least have it there? And it's not binding. Get the answers. You know why?
Sure.
Well, 2 things. Because it was Annie Petrowski's motion, and we don't want him to get, like, real headlines of how he's trying to actually seek out what
they don't even want to appear to be supporting one of your ideas.
100%. And the other thing is, maybe, and equally, and maybe worse, we don't want to know what the people have to say. And at the end of the day, they don't. We got up there. I mean, I'll maintain this, Jim. Before 2010... And Doug Harrod's called this in his editorials on and off. And I'll give him a plug here. The region, the great unwashed. It was the biggest little secret for 40 years up there. Nobody knew what the region was doing.
Hmm.
And they didn't know because nobody was reporting on it. And they probably didn't know.
No one's really paying attention because if you back in those days, if you want to pay attention, you had to go to the meetings. Now at least you can stream it online, which I've been.
And you didn't have an Andy Petrowski standing up and questioning and challenging staff. Because what you've got up there is the Mutual Admiration Society.
Mm-hmm. Known as. You finally did say
right?
Here.
and you got the Mutual Admiration Society of counselors and staff all working together and saying, hey, you know what? Staff come up with the ideas. Council, especially 12 mayors are there, I still maintain, for their city. And they're rightfully, I guess, so. That's why I think they're in a conflict. And the other 18, I guess, are less inclined to believe that their job is to challenge staff. And we're a board. Our job is actually, that is our job, to hold staff accountable. So that's not been the MO of councillors, Jim, for 40 years.
It seems like a lot in many of these communities that we seem to suffer from a tail wagging the dog syndrome, where staff 100% makes the rules and council rubber stamps.
And when Andy steps out, and when I step out and I question something, so, oh, this legal expenses issue, you know, oh, wow, let's get right into the pennies and everything else. And then on anything else, 5, 10, 20,000, a million, you're micromanaging, Andy. Don't micromanage staff. We're within budget. Oh, well, you find out budget is $30 million, the contingency is another $5 million, and we have councillors standing up and saying, we're still within budget. Now, who would run their household budget like that? If you're budgeting to put an addition on the house, you're budgeting for furniture, for carpet, whatever, you're budgeting a price you can afford. Maybe the contingency is money you have set aside in a second rainy day account that if something goes terribly wrong. But at the region, something goes wrong all the time.
Right. So all the time. While we waste time on things like governance and double direct, and then we'll get around to the integrity commissioner and code of conduct, how many, I wish I could track how many minutes and hours and days and weeks we've been jerking around with this. And you know what? I'm all for good behavior. I'm also all for
Depends how you define good.
Yeah. And I'm also for
shining. I'm for right behavior, Jim.
Well, I mean, if you can live with yourself and it's within the boundaries of the law, then I think you should be okay.
Amen.
And self-expression is important to me. Freedom and debate. Of speech. And, yeah, healthy, wholesome, maybe not so wholesome, but a healthy debate where two sides of both issues. Listen, if we stop talking, and I'm talking more the liberals and the conservatives, because really right now with the election of Donald Trump in the States, we've really seen this parting of the seas, you know, for a bad analogy using the Bible, but having the left and the right on both sides. And we forget that if the bell curve goes like this, in the middle, most of the liberals and conservatives overlap on a lot of their issues. Right. It's on the extreme, the same, which you might put a Petrowski and a Fannon out on the ends here.
Amen.
Well, I don't put myself on the extreme, but some people might. On the extreme, you get the ideological beliefs and the behaviors of the extremities that really scare you. And those are the ones that we're going, whoa, we have to pay attention to these extremes out here, because most of the people in the middle overlap and they're not the radicals. The radicals are on the end.
I like to say, instead of, they're in the tank. They're in the tank. The liberals and conservatives, those ones in the mushy middle, they're all in the tank. Don't rock the boat. Mm. The people won't know what they don't know. The people don't need to know what they don't need to know. It's all in the tank. And then you get a populist candidate like Donald Trump, like Rob Ford, like Andy Petrowski. Yeah, have conservative values and everything. Run first campaign on a populist issue, the water bill. And I believe delivered very successfully over the last 4 years and so far, although that boat seems to be teetering. But people don't like your colleagues in politics, these staid conservatives, even the party, you know, small c, big c. And I don't call myself necessarily, I'll take on and disagree with things Harper has done and Hudak have done any day of the week. I mean, Wynne is atrocious in my mind and Trudeau is equally so, but I don't mind challenging these strict party lines. But we've got these, all these people who call themselves kind of something because they actually think and they get some votes from the population who attach themselves to those parties and go, is Councillor so-and-so really there that, oh, yeah, I can vote for that. But when you get a populist candidate like myself that comes out, that doesn't really, at the end of the day, always share everything with any of those parties and just says, hey, running for the people and what do the people expect? I think I've accomplished, like, legions of coverage by the very fact that, like I said, Doug Hare, great unwashed, nobody knew what was going on. Now all of a sudden you have a couple of councillors. Bob Gale is not afraid to stand up. Councillor Barrick's not afraid to stand up. You got a couple of councillors. Councillor May, sometimes when he speaks, very, very bright and very challenging.
And knows the process inside and out.
Oh, for
he's
sure.
Always the first guy to raise a point of order.
And he knows the games because he came from the top game.
I've
line,
never
Queens
seen the
Park.
Chair question Maeve's point of order ever.
Right.
he's really well schooled in that department.
But so I want to wrap it up. He says you got all these people kind of in the mushy middle, and then you have a couple people want to stand up and actually do what I believe we were elected to do, and that is provide oversight of staff and hold staff accountable. But then, like I said, then you get all the veterans and all the middle of the tank hacks who go, oh, you know what? That guy's ruining our show. Hey, he's actually exposing things. Oh, he might be making us look bad because not making us look bad by questioning staff because they're not. Mm. They just want to stick up their hand. All in favor.
Not opposed.
Look at the vote on Jim, look at the vote on the track and field stadium. Like, come on. Nobody knew or expected, or nobody I've talked to, and I'm not talking about this 10 or 20 sports fans in Niagara, and that doesn't mean we only have 10 or 20, the ones who appreciated this, and three or four hoteliers, Jim, who are going to benefit for the 3 weeks it's here, and a couple of restaurants. But really, we're going to end up with a track and field stadium. What are we going to do with that? People
it's not
sending
even a multi-use facility.
No, it's an outdoor and it's a part-time, and all we're going to do with it is get the bills to keep it open and keep it maintained. Mm-hmm. And did anybody in the region ever expect the regional councillor to be supporting spending $10 million on a track and field stadium for these Canada Games? And I'm not saying, hey, it's not. I'm not saying it's not a bad thing. That it's a bad thing. I'm not saying winning the Canada Games is a bad thing. But is it our priority? Is $10 million mm-hmm. our priority when we got, what, 10,000 people, Jim, on the housing list?
Which brings me back to the whole waste of time. Here we go again with governance issues, with code of conduct reviews, with Mascaren, the integrity commissioners in, then they're out, then they're back. And, who's the guy that did your first interview when Preston came along with you? What was his, the first integrity commissioner?
Oh, Swayze.
What a joke. Okay, so, and now while we're here.
And then follow by
we've
by
got
the way,
an opioid crisis that's ravishing
exploding.
Our youth
exploding,
and we're not the only community in Canada or North America that's feeling that pinch. We've got a homeless
joblessness situation,
jobless taxes, homelessness, affordable housing. We've got all these things that
seniors being pinched every day. Every day,
the price of hydro. Not that we can do anything about that at the region or the city. I mean, maybe we could in retrofit.
But we can control fees and taxes.
Correct.
Or maybe at least if we're going to take money out of their pocket, like make sure the roads and the sidewalks and the bridges, and I guess that obviously the infrastructure is all safe and working. Well, then how do you make these other decisions? And
right.
I'll tell you,
well, you don't, because they don't come to council, and that's the problem. We have people like Jennifer Johnson that just spoke to committee this week, lost her son in a heroin overdose laced with, he was a talented chef.
Right.
He liked to party. His choice of drugs was something he was trying to get off, heroin.
Right.
He went to the doctor. The doctor gave him Percocets. This is in Toronto or wherever, I'm not sure. But Jennifer Johnson, who just lost her 25-year-old son, Jonathan, has to come before council and beg and plead in tears for them to please do something about this crisis. So then they pass a motion. Thank God. Something's, they're going to look into it, or they're going to look at best practices out west and another staff report, right? Or a guy like me that's got to go defend democracy to kill a double direct. Meanwhile, all these issues that they could be tackling and should be tackling aren't getting any press or any attention. And it just seems like the motivation of council is so self-serving.
And I'm glad you used the word self-serving, Jim. It's so self-serving that as long as we can feed this fake news, dishonest news, local, let's call it pop culture news. Because not even news, it's opinion makers. These guys are opinion makers. They're not reporting. I mean, you look at the story, And you might get two or three facts in it, then you get 85% of a so-called journalist's, and it's journalism, opinion. The whole purpose of this is distraction. It's not the distraction. Petrowski caused a distraction by way of what he did, because my complaints come back, like they date back, Jim, to like a year before they even hit a code of conduct. No, it's give the opportunity, feed stuff to the standard through these personal attack things like the code of conduct, so that the standard can put my lovely picture up on the front page for 3 days in a row, And meanwhile, like in the bottom right-hand corner of page 24, oh, by the way, council just spent $10 million on a track and field stadium. Or, oh, by the way, the Niagara on the Lake sewage treatment plant is late again and over budget millions. Or by the way, how about this one? The Burgoyne Bridge, and I don't even think it's still public. So here's a news breaker, which I've talked to you about already, but it hasn't come public, but it's not in camera. The bridge is another $9 to $10 million more expensive if we end up paying the current change orders. So the contractor has almost finished the project, has submitted a bill, Jim, for another near $10 million, taking it up over 100, 102 now.
Wow.
By the way, that's all available information. Those change orders are public, right? That's public information. Where is the conversation on that? No. And then ask yourself this, why doesn't the media want to cover it? Because they're in the tank with the staff and with the councillors. It's all one happy family, and Trump's fighting this too because he's not really a Republican. He's himself against Republicans, against Democrats, against the establishment media, except, I guess, Fox here and there. At the end of the day, there's no incentive even for this in-the-tank media to go after the real business of the region that affects the pocketbooks of taxpayers. Hang on. And I'll submit this to you, Jim, because the radio and the print are both receiving, I would suggest to you, decent sums of money from the region in advertising. So why are you going to bite the hand that feeds you? I don't know what the region pays the standard, but I'd be surprised if it was shy of $100,000. Well, $100,000 at the standard, Jim? Two reporters. And you know what? The radio's doing pretty good. And the radio's never going to say, we don't want that. But at the same time, listen to the tone of the questions when they bring people on. Even when they bring on Chair Caslin and try to talk, and he would like to talk about issues, they go after him on the people stuff. Like, why not talk to the chair about, Chair, what's going on with Burgoyne Bridge? Why is the sewage treatment plant in Niagara Lake have leaking concrete tanks that were just poured a year ago, and this place is supposed to last 50 years in the tank? So,
sorry about that, brother. Got a phone call and it disrupted everything. So
we have a public works commissioner who's asking now, apparently, and thankfully the media, like I said, got this twang of guilt to publish something that really means something to our taxpayers. And he's asking now for, $100+ million a year for public works infrastructure. And that may or may not be something we need, but I certainly don't believe in jacking up the rates today so that to seniors who are having trouble paying their bills, some of them, and the skyrocketing hydro, skyrocketing food prices, skyrocketing everything, and obviously medical costs and everything else. So we're asking, you know, he's come forward and saying, I need more money, but at the same time, who's holding Public Works accountable for all these projects going off the rails? So the people are entitled to know, at least know, how their money's being spent, or I would say misspent. If you're buying concrete tanks for a sewage treatment plant, aren't you entitled to have them at least leak-free for a couple years, Jim? They're leaking. And I said, and that's just one example. And then we got Burgoyne Bridge, another $9 million over budget. Not over budget, sorry. Higher on the price tag, according to the contractor, if they get paid. And typically when that comes, and which is another charade, when that whole news comes, you get the news story, and then you get the comments, well, it hasn't been paid, and it's illegal and everything else, and that one-time exposure, no follow-up, like every month. So did you pay it? Did you pay it? Did you pay it? And that's why we have such a dishonest media, and they know they are. And like I said, it doesn't serve them. You know what? It serves them to be nice. Everyone wants to be nice.
Well,
nice.
I think you've certainly got a point there. It's easier to go after a radical like Andrew Petrowski, and just harp on his whatever.
His personal Twitter account.
Yeah, or or what have you, than it is to go after the business of the region with the idea or staff or whatever. And I think it's interesting that take, and you know, it's not the first time I considered it, but you know, this is significant ad revenue coming
Absolutely.
From the region on this. And if the region was to say, okay, we're not buying advertising from you guys. What do they advertise? Oh, they, those notices in the paper, public meetings and
banner
stuff like that?
Ads for waste management, how to blue box properly, how to gray box properly, mm-hmm. whatever. But you know what? I'm not convinced that the people at the region in staff who monitor those dollars don't know they get something back in return for that, which I say is a collective silence, quite frankly, on the meaty real issue. So, oh no, we're not going there. We won't go there. We'll do the one story. We're not going to do any follow up on it, though. Mm. I mean, these are the stories that should be in the paper every day. Honestly,
and
they should
right
be
down to the Burgoyne Bridge. That report is public now, not through choice of the Niagara region, but it got leaked, and I helped leak it. And when I got my hands on it, I leaked it out. And there's still people employed by the region that are named in that report doing some pretty.
And practices that were named in that,
things, yeah.
that we were still doing, I think, up to the time that you even went public with your information, Jim, you know, like this idea, but it didn't even get explained properly. You imagine that a staff member took a piece of road, basically 1 kilometer long, and chopped it up into 10 100-meter projects so that it fell within his pay threshold. We're talking about legal expenses and counselors. Here we're talking millions of dollars of public works projects being manipulated so that a specific staff member had the ability to award all that work without any accountability to his supervisors or his superiors. And then you have to ask yourself, Jim, was the taxpayer getting value for those awards when, lo and behold, surprise, surprise, all 10 of those mini projects making up that 1 kilometer, Jim, got awarded the same contractor. Of course they did, because
it was
a 1 kilometer job.
Right.
Yeah, but this is, it's rigged. And, you know, but I want to say this, though. I do believe, so this is all historical. Okay, this is historical. We do have a new CAO up there. Okay. We have Mr. Carmen D'Angelo. And I have to say, first of all, he has to have an opportunity to be obviously held to account for the rights and the wrongs of the region, what's happening. But I do have to say that I have, from that staff perspective and from that senior leadership, a glimmer of hope that the legacy that has so ingrained the region, because it is so, and these are not the frontline people, are all hardline, hard workers, and maybe the next level of management. But beyond that, you know, senior managers to the top, Jim, you know, Carmen D'Angelo has to really look into those organizations and shake up the culture there and say, it's not business as usual anymore. We can't do this. And I hope that appears, and it should appear, and it's difficult to do because you're dealing with commissioners who control their respective department budgets, who will always say, yes, I need what I got last year. And you got to say, why? Well, we don't have zero-based budgeting. Mm-hmm. If we had zero-based budgeting, and Selena Valpati tried to bring it through, and I was working with her with
everyone
that.
Everyone trots that out at election time. We're going to zero-based budgets.
But
when they get elected, there's no zero-based budget.
No, it's because the majority of council votes against it because they don't want it, because they know we're putting management accountable for defending the very first tax dollar right up to the last one every year. And they're going to say, it's too much time. Is it really?
Resources?
Jim.
What are they doing?
Hang on. It's not too much time. Corporations do it every year. No corporation just says, oh, we got $100 million this year to build a couple of computer boards that do this game and this game. Give it to us again. The CIO is going to say, oh, you're still working on the same game? What, the region? The answer is, well, do I have to tell you? So I believe I'm going to give Carmen a plug, because I've seen what the kinds of things he's instituting with operational controls and everything else. And he's still a one-man show. Like, he's at the top, and he's, when you've got your generals underneath you, Jim, who have been there in the bureaucracy, whether it's at the region or somewhere else, for decades, there's a huge political, and let's face it, the best politicians are not the ones who sit around the horseshoe council. They're the senior managers. You didn't get to the top unless you're a great politician, and they all know that. But he's got a work with these people and really try to uncover what is really going on. I think zero-based budgeting, and if he instituted that, say, you know what, we're going to do that. We even tried to bring it in on a department basis this year, public works, next year planning, next year health and things like that. Come on, that's not too difficult, is it? Mm-hmm. So over 4 years, you'd cover all four major departments. Be fantastic. Every 4 years, you got to do one time, you got to do zero-based budgeting. And so the public understands what that is. It's that you don't just get what you got last year and ask for 2% more. You actually get nothing, and you have to ask for every dollar from the first dollar and justify where it's going. Do you agree?
No, I do, and I think it's a great idea, and I don't understand the argument that it's too labor-intensive. I mean, that's what staff is there for. But just getting back to the media's responsibility, I'm really frustrated in this town. You know, 610's gone to no local on Tommy's show, the one, you know, I used to call in on and was most engaged in. Like, I don't listen to these programs just because. I listen to them because I'm engaged and I'm interested. And,
right.
And very often back in the old days, it was conservative, many conservative callers that I would have to call and defend the liberal point of view to, not the liberal, but the green or the lefty, right, or whatever. And, you know, I'm still the same guy. I'm still a feminist. I'm still a left-leaning social conservative or right, whatever you call it. I'm not sure where, you know, but totally frustrated by what the left is doing right now, and frustrated by the media. And I tweeted out last week, I know you don't see many of my tweets, but you got so many followers and whatnot, but I tweeted out last week, if I emailed out a naked picture of myself sitting on a stool with my legs open, with a blank look on my face, there's not one media outlet and not one elected politician in this town that would call that pornographic. It's true. And I fell for it too, because I'm having a little fun at Andy's expense. Hey, if you pick your nose on the camera at regional politics, chances are a guy like Jimmy Fannin's going to tweet it out and say, I thought it was a rule about eating at your desk. That's funny. It's probably not so kind to the guy that's picking his nose. I get that. I should probably, you know, not try to be so funny and be more sensitive to my fellow human being. I think, you know, you talk about your faith and whatnot. That's not being kind.
Right.
Well, don't pick your nose on camera then.
Right.
But the media is a totally different story. So, again, if a guy like you, and I support same-sex marriage, right, I'm also a Christian. That's my belief, and that's my right, choice to support. Hey, you can't, dolphins are gay in the wild. You can't pick who you love. I happen to be heterosexual. I've got some gay friends. They're great. I have no problem. I'm still a little uncomfortable when I see two men making out at a parade or a park. You know why? Not because it's two men so much. It's because no one makes out like that in public. Right. Unless you're a kid and you're drunk at a bar and you're trying to pick up a girl or something, then I can see you making out. Otherwise, do that at home. It's not that you're gay. It makes me feel uncomfortable because people don't do that. So in a case like you, now I support same-sex marriage. That's great. I understand that you don't. You're entitled to your opinion. Now you come out and say, I am not in favor of same-sex marriage because I'm a Christian and I follow Jesus and it says in the Bible, blah, 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 and that's your interpretation or right, what have you, or maybe it's not even interpretation. It says in the Bible, if you want to take it literally, then great. That doesn't automatically make you a hate-filled homophobe.
Thank you.
If you are not in favor of liberal immigration, it doesn't make you a racist.
Correct.
It means that you're a conservative and you like your borders. You like your boxes. You think inside the box. Your personality type isn't all that creative. You're probably very lawful and dutiful and industrious. That goes with that whole conscientious personality trait of the big five that I've learned quite a lot about over the last little while. And the liberals are artistic. They think outside the box. They like free borders. They don't like boxes. They don't like the rules and laws. And the right tend to think,
but they like voters.
Yeah. The right tends to think the giants of the past were our heroes.
Right.
Right? The Johnny right, McDonald's right, or what have
right,
you.
Right, right.
And then the left points to the corruption of all those heroes. Now, right, both are actually right. They were heroes
right,
and they were corrupt. So
amen,
there's no absolute right and wrong on these
right,
things. So I'm starting to blather a little bit, but I was going back to the responsibility of the media and in particular, where as soon as that email, and I don't know how you described what that happened or whether that was somebody that was intentionally trying to, like, I mean, you just don't by accident put a picture like that in an email. Like, that takes some effort. And 100%. So I and you haven't been, in my opinion, straight with me as to what happened, because I think you're probably protecting whatever happened. And that's fine that you.
Well, I think
you.
I've been public that I haven't been public about who sent the email.
Right. But that doesn't happen by accident. But
I agree.
And that's shameful, and you're embarrassed by that, but I took responsibility for it. Yeah, absolutely.
100%.
And I apologize for it. Yeah, and I'm not saying that that's cool or anything like that, but for the media, and I fell for it, and I tweeted out, having fun at your expense, and I don't know if I told you this before, but I tweeted out something like, well, you know what, from now on, I'm going to sign all my emails and tweets with a pornographic image. I fell for it too, because the media, boom. Now I start struggling. Wait a second. I hate to say this, and I've said it publicly to my friends before. I've got a pretty decent relationship with porn. I know what porn is.
Right.
And porn is designed to sexually arouse you.
Right.
That image had nothing sexually arousing about it.
Right.
So, but the first thing, and that it really goes back to the responsibility of the media. But in a small town like this, they get to run rampant a little bit. And I think you've been successful kind of curtailing some of this nasty behavior as it comes after you. Like, there's really been a kind of a witch hunt to, you know, get Andy on whatever he does with certain reporters, and we know who they are. But well, to immediately say that was a pornographic image when, in fact, it was a nude, okay? It was a nude, no more offensive than any other nude in art or album cover or any lyric in a record. But it's not appropriate, then all of a sudden, anywhere you go, if you bring up Andy Petrowski's name, he's a hate-filled homophobe. Yeah. Hate-filled homophobe in tweets. And you know what? You say that enough times, and people that don't know, they just thought, that's that racially, sexually intolerant guy.
Right.
No. Well, that's a guy that has some belief that, you know.
But that's their game. That's the game of press. So, you know, I mean, I think this all stems back to almost day one when I got elected and Grant LaFleche had to interview me on my election night. And I forced him to, by way of him quoting me, to make sure he quoted that I gave God credit for winning that election. And here is Mr. Atheist, and he's public about it, right? We all know, right? He's public, Jim, right?
Well, that
he's
an not atheist. Only that, he'll say you're pretend little old man in the sky.
Right.
That's disrespectful to anyone that's got any faith.
Yeah, and he made fun about the Pope too. And he made fun about the Pope too, the guy with the white robe and the pointy little shoes. So, you know, it's a religious persecution thing. Grant is an atheist. He knows that I follow the Christian faith. We call ourselves believers. Not unashamedly so, boldly, and he has an issue with that. So I think this has been his lifelong, at least through my political career, attempt to go after me on whatever he can. But below it all is he has this burning kind of hatred for what I stand for and the fact that I do hold my faith. I'm a sinner. I'm not perfect.
Yeah.
But it's a religious persecution thing. And you know what? For him to get away, I guess it's okay. If he wants to get away with all of this, that's at the top. And he hides behind the curtain and says, well, I will hold these people accountable and everything else. But you know what? The fruits don't show that. The fruits don't show he's holding everybody accountable. Just this recent issue with legal expenses where it came out.
They're digging, they're investigative reporting into all the expenses to see where this shakes down, because nobody knows what's going on at the region.
But, Jim, there was nothing hidden about it. There were the policy said you have to have an invoice. I had three invoices. I submitted them openly and transparently. Everything lined up with the policy, and expenses get paid. But the same night where we debated that, it came out by way of questions asked by Councillor Barrick mostly that two of the other councillors who in the previous day, the standards say, were being covered by the insurance policy, Jim, and who apparently didn't
stopping out of the meeting.
And they didn't ask for compensation. It came out by way of questions at council that the insurance policy is covering nothing. There's $1 million deductible for both those councillors. So that
the region's
means
on the hook for it all.
Not the region. The taxpayer. The same people are paying my legal expenses. Mm-hmm. Nothing different. nothing different. They're paying for those councillors up to $1 million each. And where mine is contained, mine is done at the level of the invoices I expense, their cash register is still ringing. And then the question came up, and how did it come that we're paying for this? Because the paper said that they didn't ask. And then Commissioner Burgess at the time had to respond, truthfully, thankfully, well, the councillors had a meeting with our legal counsel. So they had a meeting about those expenses. So I guess we're supposed to believe that legal volunteered to say, hey, by the way, we'll take care of this, folks. Not to mention now that the lawsuit doesn't even name them as councillors, because the guy who filed the lawsuit went back to the courthouse, amended his statement of claim, and now is saying, no, I'm suing these as private individuals. But the lawyer kind of, you know, on a pinhead dance and said, no, we're still covering them. But did you see any correction from the Standard the next day? No. The attacks keep coming on, you know, on Andy. Fine, that's okay. I don't mind me being held accountable. Put the facts on the table. One thing I won't do is engage Mr. LaFleche with an interview because of his inclination to kind of twist and turn things
and
I say.
And for 25 years, I appreciate that. And thanks for, you know, speaking frankly. And, you know, some people might not like it, and I could give a shit, really, to be honest with you. But I've been paying those guys for 25 years for open house ads, 40, 50, 60 bucks a week.
Who?
Standard.
Right.
And Niagara This Week.
Right.
It goes in both papers, every open house. Right. Now, I haven't done the number of open house ads in over the last couple of years that I normally have done.
Right.
For a number of reasons, they don't work. They don't give me the type of business or exposure that I'm looking for. But when I was new in the business, sometimes I do four open houses a week.
It's big money.
$125 bucks a weekend
for
color pictures or sometimes black and white pictures, depending on the year.
Yeah.
But I started 25 years ago paying those guys a lot of money.
Right.
And for a number of reasons, the foremost one being, just cover fairly what's going on in Niagara and stop sensationalizing things. I just refuse now. And now print is circling the drain. And, you know, most of my open houses now, I post them on MLS. They go on MLS.ca.
Right.
And I don't really need the Standard or Niagara This Week anymore. But that's really, for a long time, guys like me, and a lot of them, we got 1,000 realtors in Niagara, have been paying this paper to keep their doors open, and what's it got us? So, you know, I'm really frustrated, you have just
a couple people with one paper in town, and then and Niagara This Week, and I will say Niagara This Week tries sometimes to present the stories with a little bit more, less opinion and more information, even if it's just quotes from people. So I'll give Scott Rose a plug that I believe he's
managing editor, and reporter.
Yeah, and, you know, notwithstanding, he has people underneath him who can inject their own political philosophy. But you can't get away from it. The Standard is one political philosophy, which is, and you know what? They hate this when I say it. It's the old Boys and Girls Club of Niagara, Jim, and it's the same old Boys and Girls Club, maybe next generation, the status quo people. They don't want things to fundamentally change unless they change for them. And quite frankly, as long as everyone believes the status quo is working, but those people are getting benefits because they have figured out the system without being exposed. And you can read into that what that means in terms of government contracts, in terms of business, in terms of getting spinoffs from $10 million track and field stadiums. Everyone wants a status quo. They don't want to rock the boat, and they certainly don't want an Andy Petrowski to be standing at the front of the ship like George Washington crossing the Delaware going, hey, guys, we're landing, except the boat's kind of empty behind me, and we're landing, and we're going to take this on.
I love when you use analogies like that. I especially love it when you compare yourselves to Jesus on the cross. Now,
never on the cross, but in the courtyard. In the courtyard. Persecution. Well,
people
come on.
People don't like it when you compare yourself to Jesus, man.
No. Jim, no, in fairness, because I'm in the faith community. I say I understand, and I'm doing, you know, I've been doing a Bible study religiously or faithfully since kind of middle of the summer. And when you're reading, and we had a great Bible series at Harvest Niagara, plug for them, on the book of Acts. When you're reading what happens in the biblical times, when people stand up for something, in this case, their faith, and what the establishment of the day doesn't want to hear, because the establishment was fundamentally affected by the new story of Jesus, because we had that we had the old law, and Jesus came and said,
they didn't accept him in and say, yeah, come on in. Even the Jews, he was an outcast even in his own community.
Amen.
The Jews persecuted him.
And you know what? If it meant that people had to have to give up power or be held accountable or maybe do things different, nobody wants to do that. And you know what? After we slice through everything we talked about so far, the bottom line is Niagara getting better or is it getting worse? The Ronald Reagan question saying, are you better off today than you were?
I think as we twiddle our thumbs and navel gaze on governance reform, on dual direct, on codes of conduct, on integrity commissioners, and all on the Andy Petrowskis of council, whoever they might be, well, it only seems to be...
And the NPCA stuff, because Jim, in fairness, why is it just NPCA? Why aren't we looking at Niagara Parks?
Gale already upset the Niagara Parks.
Was once, though, but why aren't we looking? I mean, and I'm not saying there's anything at Niagara Parks. Yeah. No, at Niagara Parks. But why is it NPCA? It's simple, because there are a few more conservatives there today than there were yesterday.
And I'm glad you said that, because, you know,
and that's all it is.
The status quo. The status quo used to be always liberal. You know, you had Gary Burrows as chair. You had Zimmerman as chair before that. You had the relationship between, you know, Mayor McMullen and regional council, and it was a left wing
100%
controlled, and I can't even look south of the border. I cannot hate on Donald Trump one bit right now, because I'm too busy hating on our own lack of democracy, lack of integrity at the region, especially the region, and the city of St. Catharines is no angel either. I can't seem to put my energy, Donald Trump to me is a blowhard, and he's a narcissistic psychopath as far as I'm concerned, an attention seeker. But I can't do anything other than just go, okay. And you know what I find is fascinating by this whole thing?
But he did say with the people, what enough people, 64 million or 62 million people.
And a lot of them, when you say populist.
And a lot of them haven't voted for terms for years. Mm-hmm. He did strike chords with people on drain the swamp, build the wall, those things, right? Mm-hmm. Lock her up.
Come on.
Everybody hated that, including his own people. Mm-hmm. Look at this Obamacare thing. I mean, we don't go there, but he can't get the repeal done, even with his own people, because hacks, and they're hacks, like McCain in his own party, hated him so much for getting president. Nobody thought on November 8th they'd wake up and find Donald Trump president. Nobody thought. I mean, the numbers didn't even cross until 10 o'clock midnight, Jim. So
I don't think even Donald Trump thought he was going to make it.
Possibly. So the region today, you know, is kind of like, I'll say this, people aren't getting their money's worth. Jim,
so
they're not
how about
getting
the status
they're not
quo getting their now, though, Andy? Now that your guys are in power, Castlin's traditionally...
Oh, we're not in power.
Well, Castlin's traditionally a conservative. He was appointed by the... it was a conservative,
but he's
maybe
just,
not a majority.
It's a figurehead position.
Yeah, a damn good one, too, a really good paying one. And, you know, Rick Dykstra was the kingmaker in a lot of these elections, both municipally and regionally.
Well, I'm not sure what that means, kingmaker.
Well, he got everyone elected except Joe Cahill. Anyone that was on a Dykstra ticket was elected.
What do you mean a Dykstra ticket, though?
Well, he helped them with people, with resources, with... and then when they went over...
You don't
when,
hang on. You don't
when
think,
he asked Secord's people to stop, okay, you got to go over and support Walter now so that Jeff doesn't get in. You know what the first question was after Walter was elected? Who are we going to make chair? Okay, let's go talk about it.
You're giving Rick way too much. You're giving Rick way too much power, though, honestly. And here's what's funny, that you're just playing right into what the media loves is that what about the liberals? What about, you just said, at least you flush them out and said they've been in control.
Mm-hmm.
But
I don't think they were ever that organized.
Well, they didn't have to be because they occupied every seat.
Mm-hmm.
But the thing is, you think they've disappeared? Have they disappeared at the region?
No.
Do you think the power broking in the back rooms has disappeared? Do you think they just gave up if, you know, you suggest that maybe...
Well, they're just looking at the next term of council, probably.
Yeah, but even in the vote for chair, it was... who was it down to? Gary against Al Castlin? You don't think that there was some power broking going on there?
Mm.
And how did Gary get in? I mean, that surprised everybody. We were all caught up with Damian Goulburn maybe running, and I can't even remember who it came down to. And then Gary runs up the middle and gets the job. But that was all orchestrated by the left. You know, so let's call it. It's happening on both sides, Jim. It happens on both sides. You know, you get as far as my political, like, obviously I lean more to the right than the left. I'm pro-life. I'm pro-traditional marriage, which doesn't make me, I guess, a baby phobe or a baby genist or whatever you want to call me.
Oh, yeah. If you oppose the death penalty.
No, actually, no, I guess.
Nobody gives a shit.
Being pro-life could make me a misogynist because.
Oh, well, no, you hate women.
I hate women.
Yeah. If you're a pro-life.
Yes.
Then you absolutely have no respect and you hate women.
And you know who I hate
the
most?
Greg Millers out there.
You know who I hate the most?
Who think it's okay when the pro-lifers are standing on the corner with their disgusting pictures of little fetuses and stuff like that. Like, that's not for me to decide what you think's appropriate or what's offensive. And yeah, if I had kids, I don't want them driving by that, but I'm certainly not going to say, make it illegal. You can't stand on the corner and demonstrate. No, you know what? So, and then dude comes up with something, magic marker written all over his bare chest, goes up and basically assaults these people by taking their signs, kicks them, the signs all over, stomps on the signs on the ground. He gets arrested for public mischief, should have been assault. Because if you take my sign and right. stomp on it, you might as well spit in my face or throw water on me
Amen.
Or throw blood on me or whatever. That's assault, so he should have been charged for assault. So the Greg Millers of this world will come out and go, more of this. More of this. What? Assault over free speech? And then now I'm a snowflake. A snowflake? And the other day, Jordan Peterson puts this thing out. It's this LGBTQ2SPIA+, it's getting longer and longer and longer, right? So I just happened to retweet one of his things. It comes from the University of Alberta. It's a Gender and Sexuality 101. And in one thing it says here, this is what caught my eye. Treat people with respect, blah, blah, blah. Five, challenge assumptions. Studies completed in the past 5 years estimate that over 50% of Generation Zs, born between 95 and later, do not identify strictly heterosexual or cisgender. 50% of people born after 1995 don't identify with, like, are you fucking kidding me? So I put this out, and I say something to the effect of, more bullshit from the compelled speech lefty madness crew that dominates our higher learning institutions. Because we all, right. well, we don't all know, but I've come to understand now that these professors and teachers are all lefties.
Amen.
There's no conservative, there's very few conservative profs. And if there is, and even the students can't get a conservative movement going because everyone's equality at all costs, legislated. We're equal. We're not freaking equal. We're not as human beings, not as races, not as sexes. We have differences in wirings and mental.
For very good reason.
Yeah. I mean, now we're going to roll into to the nurses' union and we're going to go, oh, okay, there's too many women in this field. We're going to we need some quotas. No. We're going to go to the Jews. Okay. In Hollywood, are we going to break up this, there's too many Jews? No. In the Asian community, the Asians do things way better than a lot of white people do, and they dominate some fields. In the STEM field, is poor James Damore, not poor, but they fire this kid for this anti-diversity memo, which is basic biological science.
The Google guy.
Yeah. Women don't have the personality type for STEM fields. Well, the majority of women don't.
How
and that's why
you?
It's dominated
how
by men.
Jim, how dare you?
No, because now he's
how dare you?
A sexist and he's
how
a homophobe.
Dare you? How dare you?
So oh. I put this out
and
here.
Imagine someone today would say.
Social justice warriors, politically
yeah.
correctness.
Social justice warriors.
Mad.
And the liberal.
So David Clough, this clown from Welland, who's a total social justice warrior in a wheelchair mm-hmm. and ran for the Green Parties last time. First thing on the Facebook, I hope you're not running again after posting all of this. I'm like, well, I said, wait, the guy that supports free speech is okay with compelling speech because the idea is they're going to have to use Z and Zer and these made up non-specific gender pronouns with these trans sexuals or whatever. And by the way, I'm okay. Love whoever you want. Cut your sexual parts off and install new ones if it makes you feel better. But don't tell me you're changing your sex because every freaking cell in your body is coded for a man. Doesn't matter what you do with your parts. Doesn't matter how much estrogen you consume. Whether your voice changes, you grow new boobs. You're a boy. And then they trot out. Oh, my God, you got me rolling now. Then they trot out this 10-year-old kid named Charlie in Canada, the Liberals, Trudeau's Liberals, right, with this Bill C-16. They trot out Charlie. He's 10. He wants to be a girl. He's 10. Do you think he even knows? He hasn't even hit puberty yet. So now they can, because he identifies as a girl, they're going to force him with estrogen to try and have a female puberty instead of a boy's puberty.
That's impossible.
Here we are. We won't let you get a freaking tattoo until you're 18, but we'll let you get your junk chopped off and have new sexual parts installed like you know, like you can think for yourself at 10 years old. It's appalling. So, and I took a little
I don't think installed. I think manufactured or created.
Scott Wright, one guy comes, I don't have a problem with this either, David Cloud. I think Jim's quite, point's relevant and we need the debate. It's real. Darcy Higgins comes out, sounds like a reasonable request, not demands. If you're going to rage, it should be about trans people being killed and otherwise depressed. All right, to the Greg Millers out there. Society was built on the backs of the oppressed, by the oppressors. That's how we built society? No. But down here, this dude says...
Which dude?
No, here we go. Tommy Taylor. I think he's a Green Party guy.
For full disclosure, you know, you have that line underneath each of the major networks. Just because Andy Petrowski is sitting here and Jim is talking like this doesn't necessarily mean Andy agrees with everything Jim says. No, because when you retweet something, you could retweet something. Hang on. I could retweet something I don't agree with.
No, absolutely.
Right? And so, and then I love the John Mascaren line, you are what you tweet. Really? John, did we pay you $100,000 to say that? Oh, no. Guess what? You know who got ripped off? The taxpayers got ripped off. They didn't get ripped off that I had to defend myself against a corrupt code of conduct system. I got to get this out in 10 seconds, Jim. Look at
it.
At least those two other counselors got protection under the insurance policy, but it's all paid up front as cash for the first million. They got protection by a legal framework which held a certain amount of accountability around process. The process followed by this integrity commissioner was no process. Mm. It was his process, and I guess the process of the counselors who could pick up the phone, yes, and ask him what to do or give him advice. Do you imagine that? I called it out as obstruction of justice, actually, because it is. Councillor Gale called it out as fraud. It is fraud. And why is it fraud or fraudulent? Fraud maybe isn't even the right word. It's corrupt. It's corrupt that you can call. When did you know that a judge, Jim, if you get in problems with the law and you're going in front of the court tomorrow, as a lawyer, can I call up the judge the night before and say, hey, Harry, you know what? We're fishing next weekend. Can you take it easy on Jim? Or how about this? The other lawyer calls and go, can you nail Jim? Because you know what?
He's my political foe.
Well, no, he sold a house. He sold a house to somebody else that I was trying to get or whatever it is. So in my situation, Jim, I'm not entitled to know who the accuser was. In fundamental principle of law right there in the charter and the Constitution, according to the supremacy God and under rule.
Suspend jurisprudence.
100%.
There is nothing to say due process for you.
But Section 7 of the charter says life, liberty, and security of the person. Security of the person. And it says, as it is in accordance with the principles of fundamental justice. In other words, if you break the law under Section 7, you're not entitled, finally, to security of the person. You have to go to jail. Right? So you lose that. But you have the principles of fundamental justice. What principles did John Mascaren fall? He said, no, you don't get to know who your complainant is. So it's an anonymous complainant. No, you don't get to see the complaint. I don't even know what I'm charged with. His interpretation. You're not entitled to a fair hearing. I'm making a decision. He calls it a finding. Before you even get to talk. Ludicrous. And
so
the last
finding comes out and then you're
what do you got to say?
Yeah.
it's actually like before you're going up for the execution squad.
Exactly the same as the Human Rights Tribunal, which I'm sure you're not a big fan of, and I'm only just like I knew it was there and I knew kind of what their leanings were, but nobody's ever lost at the Human Rights Tribunal. You can bring anything before these guys and get, and this goes back to the whole now I'm a homophobic bigot. This guy's Tommy Taylor. You, Jim, and Jordan Peterson are two of the phoniest faux intellectuals going. Glad you can gloss over your bigoted prejudice with Peterson's laying academia. Did you even read the proposal? Like, blah, blah, blah. So because
hang on a second. Is this person identified? You actually know who he is?
Yeah.
First and last name?
Yeah, Tommy
Good.
Taylor. I don't
Good.
Know if he goes by that real
handle.
And then he goes on about Trump's Kekistan online troll army. You ever seen this green frog? The army of Kek?
Yes.
I think it's hilarious.
I do too.
It got hijacked, and there's nowhere that I can find that this frog is anything but a freaking joke.
Right.
But now he's the symbolism of Trump's racism, right?
Right.
And I think it's unbelievably hypocritical of the left right now, mostly. You know, the Madonnas out there. And I used to love Madonna as a creative artist. But so you got Trump out here who's misogynist. He's a little narcissistic, a little psychopathic probably. I think we all display symptoms on a spectrum of all these mental illnesses. We all got a little OCD.
Not mental illnesses. You mean defective qualities.
Yeah. So here's Trump. He comes out and he stands and he spews all this garbage, right? You know, the grab him by the pussy thing, which I think, come on. Every guy that you know said something worse than that, you know, between two guys. Like, come on, really?
Absolutely.
I'm not defending Trump to say that. But so he spews all this crap out there, and people are right to be triggered, social justice warrior term. So he spews intolerance and his hate and blah, blah, blah out there. And then the left gets a hold of it and they take it. And they get their own intolerance and hate all revved up.
Not their own. They always had it.
Throw it back at them. And never thinking, oh, my God, I'm doing the same thing. That's why I can't hate on the guy. Because if I hate on him publicly and I spend time and energy hating him back as something he said, then I become him. And so I tweeted the other day, what you see in Donald Trump is what you hate about yourself. You just don't even recognize it. So... A huge
it is. That's a pretty
hypocrisy.
Pretty interesting observation.
And I think it's a conversation that we need to have. And at some level, I'm grateful for Donald Trump, even though I believe in almost nothing of what he's doing. I love Pauly Shore's take that if him and Rodman flew over to North Korea, they could solve this problem with a game of Blades of Steel. Like, just play some Nintendo together. Because this kid, this Kim Jong-un, he loves America. He loves capitalism. He loves Major League Baseball. He loves basketball. He loves The Apprentice. Like, he is the biggest Trump fan going.
Wow.
And
is this true?
Rodman goes over there and hangs with him all the time. They golf. They play video games. They hot tub together. And Rodman's a little bit of a freak.
Right.
But, like, and Pauly Shore's like, I know Dennis Rodman. And he says that if Trump just paid this kid the time of day,
right,
this stuff would go away. So, but he can't come out and say, I love Donald Trump, I love the Apprentice, because he's a dictator.
And Trump actually once said, in real Trump talk, because there is real Trump talk, but inside all of us, there's real stuff, probably with me more than 90% of the real and 10% of the phony versus the average politician, is vice versa. But Trump even came out once at one time and said, Maybe someday I'll be able to talk to him. That's real Trump talk, because he's a business guy. He, at the end of the day, is a face-to-face guy. Let's have a chat. Mm-hmm. But his handlers, Jim, his handlers in the White House, and they've all moved around lately, and I think it's getting worse, not better, but his handlers go, you can't say that. You know why? We have a military complex we have to keep pumping with billions more to put more planes up in the air or more boats. So go out and crash champagne bottles over our aircraft carriers. But please never say we want peace. America doesn't. Well, I shouldn't say that. There are some in America who don't do well economically by peace, Jim. Look at all.
No.
Under Bush, under Obama. Hey, Republican, conservative. Who has a better record in war? Neither. Mm. Neither. They're both atrocious. And they both were feeding the same system. To your point earlier, they're all overlapping in the middle. We call it same church, different pew. It's disgusting. And one's inclusive and one's not inclusive. Conservatives are not non-inclusive. They're not inherently racist. They're not inherently bigoted. They may have values, but just because you have a value like pro-life doesn't mean you're a misogynist. You know what?
Right.
You know which woman I hate the most, Jim, as a pro-life guy? My biological mother, who adopted me, put me up for adoption. That's the one I hate the most. The one who put me up for adoption, Jim.
I knew you were hate-filled. I knew it.
No, but I'm saying it's complete sarcasm.
No,
if it were not for if we're not for my biological mother, who had a child, an older sister, so I have this stepsister or half-sister out there, 7 years older than me, that I haven't found or look for yet. If she had not realized that, hey, I can't, you know, weekend romance, got pregnant, Andy came along, that I couldn't put him up for adoption, hey, we wouldn't be having this interview. Mm. So I'm saying that in sarcasm. There's no hate. I love the fact. I, you know, in heaven, I hope I hug my biological mother and she hugs me and says, hey, Andy, I'm the one. You know what? I always want to know what you look like. Now, I didn't want to know so much. But no, but seriously. Jim, all this stuff is, this isn't about even parties, even though parties is how we choose to define. Everyone wants to belong, right? People inherently do want to belong.
Be loved. Yep. Accepted.
And guess what?
Don't want to be ridiculed.
Some people, and some people, I try to get my love obviously from family and from my God, because I believe in my faith. God loves me unconditionally, doesn't like sin, but he loves me. I'm always love. Yes, you're love. God is love. 1 John 4, God is love. Some people, I guess, when faith isn't part of their life, find their love in what I call idols. You know what an idol is?
If you alcohol.
Well, no, but your government party. If you find your worth in your government party, I'm sorry. And some do because you belong. Then you attach to it. And when you attach to it, you get a set of beliefs. And you get a set of beliefs. Mm-hmm. At the end of the day, Jim, here's the problem. It's we all have those. They're inherent with us. We all want to belong. We all have these, you know, we get our support. We get our recognition from all this worldly stuff. And it has taken away at the municipal level where we're supposed to be not parochial, or sorry, not partisan. Parochial right. is your geography. Your partisanship is your party. Wouldn't it be nice? Wouldn't it be nice if we just had 1 week of completely nonpartisan and non-parochial decision-making? I'll tell you what, if we had a month of that a year, Bob Gale has this new idea where he messes us all up once a month.
Makes you sit in different
makes
seats.
Makes us sit in different seats.
Wouldn't really? Is that still...
Yes, it's an ongoing.
Still goes on.
Still goes on.
I remember that. Yeah,
I think I got to miss it because I was away for part of it, which was great. But anyway, no, wouldn't it be nice if we had a month where we go, okay, guess what? When you stand up and you debate something, you got to debate you or vote for something. You have to put some cogent words around why this should happen and shouldn't happen. And you don't get away with sticking your hand up and saying I support this. You actually have to speak to that motion. And wouldn't it be nice, and this is the flip side, if the public came and actually watched it? Because right now, and the Standard knows this, the radio knows this, better call it CKTB so they get a plug however they want to take it or not. Niagara This Week knows it. Nobody's in the audience. Nobody's engaged unless it's Let's Attack NPCA This Week and you get the same olds, right? Mm-hmm. It is. Or it is a specific issue, you know, like last term it was the Southern tier hospital people didn't want Fort Erie Hospital closing or whatever. But Jim, we don't even have an engaged public who are coming. In the States, on the other side of the river, every night in town councils, in county councils, which is like regional government, and state councils, those gymnasiums, those part-time classrooms that are converted in council room, they're full. Hmm. They're full. People I even watched engaged. One up. I just watched a Collingwood council meeting or a Barry one where there was a code of conduct issue and they actually came in support of her, you know, leave Sylvia here or something like that. I said, but where are the people in Niagara? And I know what they're saying. They're saying, well, they could say, well, we voted for you, expect you to do. But do they really, Jim, do they know what's going on? No. And you can't rely on that birdcage liner to tell you what's going on. You can't.
I kind of agree with you, too. On some things, the politicians are elected to make the decisions. On some things, they're just too big. You have to go to the public. But I want to pick up on something you said.
Can we finish this last thing, though? Yeah. Okay. So who, when they go to the voting booth, besides, oh, well, Petrowski did this, Petrowski did that, and, hey, you know, you say there's no such thing as bad pub publicity, but who... Okay, apart from me, and apart from the negative, the attempt to attack and go after Caslin, the chair, go after sometimes Bob Gale's chair of police board, and Dave Barrick or Sandy Annunziata, and knows who's always the targets? Who's the targets? It's the them and the us side. The left is fine. Leave the left alone. But you're going after the, I call them the non-left, because in the non-left, we have councillors, you know, Selena Volpatti's a great liberal. And yet, mm-hmm. she is a great,
she's not leftist.
She's a councillor that holds people accountable. I mean, she's running at the front of the boat on the Burgoyne Bridge. But But at the same time, where come election time, are the people getting their knowledge for who to vote and who not to vote? Do they know? And that's okay. Do they know Andy Petrowski was the only person out of 30 who stuck his hand up and say, I'm not voting for that $10 million track and field stadium? And I'm okay if the sports people say, well, I'm not voting for him because he did. And I'm the only one who will go on this radio now and remind people, because the other 29 are hoping that if you don't like the sports stadium, they'll still get the vote. And if you do, or they'll forget about it. But do the people, Jim, know? Does the paper even, you know what the scorecard will be? The scorecard will be Grant LaFleche's little online article with the 30 articles he's done on me, 30 or 40, whatever it is, and counting. I mean, get a life, Grant. Come on.
Mm.
You know what? Find something else to do, like be a real journalist. Oh, did I say that?
Columnist.
Pardon me?
Columnist. He's not a journalist. He's an opinion haver.
Hack opinion maker.
Man. This idea, and I've been struggling with this too, and this is kind of why I've been quiet. You know, I've done a couple of interviews with musical guests, and we touched on kind of stuff like this, but I'm having a hard time articulating my frustration up until this point, and so thanks for being my first victim. I kind of feel like what you said, we're not born with hate. I feel like we are.
I didn't. Where did I say that?
Well, I thought I heard you say that, but
biblically, we're all born sinful, so yeah, we are born with it. The first thing a baby does when is cry for attention, and the first thing a baby does when they start talking is say the opposite of what you're asking them. So, did you do that? No, no. I think it's
Obama comes out the other day and says we're not born with hate; it's learned. I think
he's wrong.
I think that. Like
I'm not sure
Donald
it's hate,
Trump
but we're born
and
with sin.
Andrew Petrowski and Jim Fannon, we're all born hateful, intolerant, bigot assholes, basically. And it's hard work to be loyal to your wife. It's hard work to be acceptable, intolerant of somebody that looks different or sounds different or moves differently or whatever. And I'm not an expert on this, but I certainly have found enough evidence that points like chimps practice organized war. They don't have religion. They fight over resources. They'll fight over women, too. But they have these territories where the resources, the bananas or whatever they're eating, and they have these territories that they patrol the outside of. And while they're patrolling, they go on patrols with all the men go out, and the women stay back at home taking care of the little guys. And when they're out on their patrol and their boundaries, if they come across a rival tribe, they pull each other apart, like murderously, like absolutely kill everything they see on these borders. And then... And tribes of usually no more than 30 or 40, that's how big chimps tribes normally are, they go into organized, they will march like an army into foreign lands and disseminate and obliterate and exterminate, practice genocide on every male chimp. Then they take the females hostage back to their clan, and then they... encompassed a new territory. It's genocide.
So what are you saying?
I'm just saying that's our closest, if you believe it.
I don't.
Well, that's why they call it a theory
evolution. I'm a creationist. I believe that God created.
There's holes in creation.
But
there's holes in evolution.
But still.
We have the closest DNA.
I believe those are instincts.
Like 98% DNA matches.
We're mammals.
So is it fair to say that, we're warlike.
I don't believe
We're intolerant. We are.
But not because they are, Jim. I come from the school of creationism. It's in human nature. It's human nature. We are fundamentally born as sinners. That's the first three chapters of Genesis carry that pretty quickly. The fall of man, the Garden of Eden, and we are fundamentally sinners from the get-go. So it doesn't matter. You may think or want to. You may want to evolve from an ape, and before that, green pond
even
scum.
Even before when we're Neanderthals. Like, I mean, there's been ancient humans on this earth for a long time. The earth isn't 2,000 years old. You're not going to tell me that, right? Like, there's...
No,
6,000
years old. No, mankind is 6,000 years old.
Okay, well, I don't know how we can agree on that. But
we don't have to.
We at one time we were in tribes, and when our tribe came up against another tribe, we didn't invite them over for dinner and sex.
Absolutely.
We tried to obliterate them.
Jim, if
that history is true,
that's even recorded since in the Bible. If you ascribe as I do to 6,000 years of the formation of man and woman as Adam and Eve, and then what happened after that up to the flood, there still were tribes wiping each other out.
Absolutely.
By the thousands and the tens of thousands. Yeah. So
where do we get off thinking that it's born good and intolerant? And,
so Obama says we learn
hate.
Well, but
you can be taught hate. There's no doubt.
Hang on, but there is certainly some socializing and some teaching going on from parents. If your parents are Archie Bunkers, chances are when you're 8 or 10, you sit at 10, you can't know that you want to be a woman if you're a boy. But if your parents are bigots, chances are you don't know differently. You won't know differently.
Fair enough.
And you might.
And it can be taught or learned or indoctrinated or whatever you want to call it.
And how does that affect us at in the great region of Niagara?
Well, I think that the conversation about Trump should start out as, we're all racist, intolerant, bigot assholes at our core. We've learned and we've come a long way to be tolerant. And I've experienced that. I tell the story about my friend Josh. First time I met him, what's this? He's a big, brown, flamboyant. I think he's gay. I've never actually asked him, but I mean, he does the pride functions and stuff like this. And I'm looking at him, and I'm like, dude, it's weird, man. And I see him the same next day, and and then I have to give him a ride. He just happens to be in a mutual friend of a friend of mine, and so I'm giving him a ride. And he's an artist, so he asked me to put a CD in the deck, and I'm like, yeah, I'll put your CD in the deck, though. And he's in the back seat of my car, and he's going, well, can you put it in now before we get there? And I'm like, now? Yeah, before we get to Niagara Falls, so we can all listen to my disc. I reluctantly put the thing in,
but I don't
and I'm hating on this guy the whole time because he's big. He's a 6'5", big, brown, flamboyant. He's not like me.
Right.
And right away, my gaydar or whatever it is goes off. I'm like, dude, get away from me. I'm not tolerant is my first reaction.
But you're
and the whole time, I'm processing
but Jim, you're
this
doing
going.
That, you're doing that as an adult. I think racism and bigotry are attitudes, first of all, and they're more something people grow into. I don't think you're born a racist. I think that if you were what about mixed families? When you have mixed children through adoption, whatever, they all get along. They all love each other.
Kids walk up against strangers all the time, and they're like, ixnay, just because you don't even have to be a different color or religion. You're a stranger. Stranger danger. Anyways, to finish my story about Josh, I put his damn disc in the thing. We're listening to it. I got a car full of guys on the way to the thing, and I'm weirded out by this guy. By the time we get to Niagara Falls, we're all yelling out the windows, Chibaba, singing to this guy's tune. And he's a beautiful man. He's a great guy that I know now. Now I see him as actually a beautiful human being, as opposed to a guy that I kind of was not fearful of, but like, you're just like, well, wait, you're like, no, stop.
Right.
You're different.
But
I think that's natural.
How about this?
We start the conversation by saying, listen, it's natural to fear people that are different from us, then that's where that conversation have to start. Because if we start out the conversation, which we always have been saying, hate is bad, and it's learned, then we're not getting anywhere. If we start out from the standpoint that, no, hate is actually pretty inherent as a human being.
Right.
It's in all our hearts. We're not tolerant. It's hard work to be loyal to your wife. It's hard work to be inclusive of the people that are brown and speak differently or loved the same sex or a different sex than you or worship a different God. It's very difficult to be tolerant and loyal and inclusive. And I think, I'm hoping that if we started the conversation with that self-admission that we're all broken sinners, then maybe we'll get further down the line because we're getting better.
I'm all for that.
But we're getting better, right?
I think, Jim, I think you might get common ground on you. First of all, yeah, the spirit is willing, the flesh is weak. Yes, this nature, I still call it, inherent sin in us and our sinful nature. And I think whether people believe in that or not, we certainly are. You might go to the extreme of born, we are bigoted, we are racist. We certainly have a prejudice, for sure. Mm. And I think we all battle with prejudice in terms of what is prejudging. We see somebody and instantly our mind puts that person in some type of a category. Mm-hmm. That's our nature, whether it's a good category or a bad category, right? Depending on how they look.
Exactly.
Unfortunately, but we've also been socialized and by our family and by the world what we should be thinking when we see those people, unfortunately, to some extent, mm-hmm. because otherwise, you know, we have blank slates. As far as the lies of hate and cheat and steal and gossip and pride and covet, I think, you know, and of course your audience is going to go crazy on this. I think that we're born that way. We are born with those sins in us. Mm. And because where does that come from? Where does a child 3 years old sitting beside his cousin who got better Christmas presents, let's say, or got ones that he liked, where does that child come up with crying and grabbing that from them? Where? That's not taught. That's not the Obama taught.
Got it.
It's there. And I'll say, for the grace of God, you know, we do have a book I fully believe in, as you know, called the Holy Bible, which teaches not, you know, whether this is good or bad as much as right and wrong, because I think they're different. You know, what is right and what is wrong? Is cheating right? No, it's wrong, right? Is stealing right? No, it's wrong. And good or bad? Think of those words, good or bad. Oh, that's, they have so much play in the middle. Oh, is it really good or really bad? It's either right or wrong. Mm. Hence, for example, you know why, on a personal level, I decided it was the right thing to apologize on a personal basis for what I had said about a specific mayor and to apologize for
Was that plastic face or snake? Or no, disgusting. Oh, okay, I remember.
Disgusting was it was both. And all were wrong. So I'm saying it's right, wrong. It's wrong. And that's wrong according to a code that I ascribe to, which is taught to me in the Holy Bible. And
now, the disgusting mirror one, I can almost give you a pass on because you were at a meeting where they blocked you from legitimately speaking. So
correct.
I can see where that could be frustrating because you're like, okay, well, you're a guy that knows process pretty well. You're there. I think you're
as
representing a constituent.
Yes.
And
constituent couldn't make it because his brother-in-law was in the hospital all night before.
So
I was there to just read notes off of a script. The clerk
had... What was the fear? That you were going to let loose with an Andy Petrowski tirade and rip council to shreds while you're on the lectern?
Perhaps.
Perhaps.
Perhaps, yeah. Or perhaps... But the fear wasn't... You couldn't have even been in the content because you can manipulate the content at those meetings.
Mm-hmm.
We have this ludicrous thing, Jim, and you believe in democracy, and God bless you for it, and the open and everything. We allow a professor or the president of Brock University on the fly to come forward and speak to region, right? On the fly.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Unannounced, sits in the audience. Oh.
Added from the floor to the agenda.
Do we have any script? Do we have any clue what they're going to say? No.
Everyone else, but
Jim Fannon, you got to submit by Thursday, the week before 4:30. Oh, and by the way, in some councils or in some townships, like maybe the one I was talking about, they can look at it and go, no, we're not going to allow this. And even at the region, there's attempts to manipulate. And
remember when the region tried to stop presenters from coming to the council?
Do I remember?
I ran on it. Before you were elected.
No, I ran on that.
Right.
I ran on that 2010. Yeah, the August before the election in 2010, the Council of Organizational Review Committee, aptly named Cork, as in put a cork in it, all those councillors passed, at least the majority of them, we will not allow any delegations to come to council. And then when I got elected, the first thing I tried to do in the fall is to change that, and my favorite mayor, Mr. McMullen, tried to jump ahead on, even though he was part of the committee and part of the council, at least the council, maybe not the committee, that voted to do that. He tried to go, oh, I want to change that. Oh, come on. So we changed that. We got rid of it. But you know what? They're going through the process all over again, Jim. I haven't been as involved. It's called the procedural bylaw. Everything, as far as I'm concerned, is sold to the public as making things more efficient and everything. Why? Why should things be more efficient? How many speakers do we really have, Jim, that come to council?
Yeah.
Not that many. And you could have rules like, Jim, you can't come three councils in a row and present the same thing.
Steve Sues, what's up with him? He's at every committee meeting
but,
and every
But he speaks
meeting.
Of different things, though.
Yeah.
I heard he spoke at the opiate meeting.
He did.
God bless him.
Yeah.
God bless him. Hey.
Well, he seems like he's addicted to it. He can't stop.
Jim, at least there are people coming forward and doing public delegations.
Well, that's my point that we started out down this road on. Why the hell should Jimmy Fannon and Steve Suess and Jennifer Johnson have to go address these things and get Jennifer Johnson's, she lost her son. Right. And she's been mourning for years over this.
Was this at Public Works? Yeah. Public Health, you mean?
Yeah, Public Health.
This week?
Yeah.
Okay.
And then she just happened to run into a couple similar moms that lost their child to overdoses or opiates or fentanyl. That's right. What her son's thing was heroin.
Sad and too common.
And it was 99% fentanyl.
Wow. Like,
that kid didn't stand a chance.
Right.
And yeah, heroin's not good, but geez, if it was legal and taxed and regulated, and we have safe injection sites, maybe we wouldn't have this problem. But this is, you know, one of my major
points.
Were
you there for a presentation?
No, I wasn't.
Did you watch it?
I did watch it.
Okay. And did she get any questions?
She did, but she completely, understandably, lost it.
Right.
Like, and she was so emotional and angry, and her voice was...
No doubt. She was
yelling at these guys to get it right. Like,
right.
Otherwise, we're losing a whole generation of kids. And, you know,
but you know,
it shouldn't be on us to go there and do the business of the region. And so now it takes four moms, Jennifer Johnson included, and I'm sorry, right. I don't know the names of the other women that were there, to come to council and passionately plea and form this whole activism group.
Right.
Like, Jennifer Johnson's got better things to do. Trust me. I know the woman.
Right.
She does not enjoy public speaking. In fact, this is probably the first time she's ever publicly spoken.
And we've
before.
Had this crisis at least for the last 3 or 4 years.
Yeah, and the region's doing jack shit about it. And it takes a girl like Jennifer Johnson, who just lost her son not more than two years ago, to come to council and to tell them, this is what you need. You need safe injection sites. You need to study best practices out west in Vancouver, mm-hmm. where the opioid crisis is raging.
How about you need doctors?
These guys
to
need to be.
Did
you guys, you've council turkeys should have this as the business of the day.
Amen.
Like this, like housing, like taxes, like, oh my God, there's so many things. But what are we talking about? We're talking about a $25,000 Petrowski bill, which, and you, I don't need to tell anybody this, and I've told you know this, I don't agree with everything Andy Petrowski.
Right.
I, in fact, agree with very little about what Andrew Petrowski does politically, but lately,
it was 44, by the way.
44,000. Okay.
Yeah. Because they'll be in TV land.
But when you came up on this code of conduct thing, I can see it clear as day. This is the Human Rights Tribunal. This is suspension of jurisprudence.
By the council.
By the Integrity Commission.
Yeah, with the support of council.
Absolutely.
100%.
And this is completely
there are only two people
wrong.
Vote against it.
And I don't understand how any code of conduct, and that's why when you challenge this, I was like, go for it, man,
right.
Because all these codes, you'll change every code of conduct in the
Amen.
Province and possibly Canada right. by saying the code of conduct cannot contravene the Charter of Rights.
Amen. And that's why the Liberal judge squashed me down, because he knows that if it goes past him, which it could through appeal, but if he was forced to rule on Charter Rights, which he tried to ignore all throughout his decision when I tried to get that injunction, and shame on him. And I'll say that openly, shame on him. And I said it openly anyway, because they all come from their pool of liberals, liberal lawyers, and then they get up there and they're, who does he work for? He works for Kathleen Wynne, who pays his check. So I don't mind.
Doesn't it make you feel like it's stacked? And I do that.
Well,
I want the
American system
day.
For 4 years. I want elected judges. And they go, oh, well, that's corruption too, because they're going to be running on campaigns. You know what? Let's try it, because the current system isn't working. But anyway, at the end of the day, this guy knows that if that had gotten farther and he had allowed me to go where I was going on the Charter of Rights, which is a Charter of Rights, which is Section 2, Freedom of Expression, Section 7, a violation of my security of person by not following any, and this hasn't even come that public either, Jim, which is just atrocious, to allow me to sit there as he did through that court proceeding and know, as he was hammering me for where is my copy of my sworn affidavits that I'd serve people, the other side, the region's lawyer, their sworn affidavit to serve me with his information. Do you know what it said? Unsuccessfully served. I never had the other lawyer's information.
So while he's taking you apart for not serving properly, nobody was served properly.
No, no, no. I had served properly.
Oh, but except he was asserting that you didn't, though, right?
No, no, no. He had asked for proof. Oh. He had asked for proof, and he said, well, you can't serve through the clerk's office. Fine. So the ones who did get served personally were the reason why we had the trial. That's fine. The point is, he had a piece of paper that documented from the region side and the region's lawyer that the region's lawyer had never successfully served me with his documentation. I'm sitting through this trial without the benefit of knowing the other side's arguments, Jim. Mm. And he had this piece of paper there all along. And then he gets to costs. And I finally asked, because someone in the audience had seen this, he said, Andy, ask, what is this courier charge? So I said, what's this courier charge? Oh, that's for you being served. Well, Your Honor, I didn't get served. Oh, that kind of looks like... So the whole trial... Had he done, I say, his job properly, and he didn't, listen to me, you know, Justice, you didn't do your job properly, as far as I'm concerned, or fairly anyway, he would have said, I see that Councillor Andy Petrowski has not been served the documents from the other side. Because both sides know going into all courts what your arguments are, right? It's called discovery and then book of this and book of that. I didn't have anything. I'm sitting there basically naked to the arguments of the other side, and he allowed that to happen. Had he done the same thing? Oh, Mr. Purcell, where's your sworn affidavit? Oh, here it is on my desk. Unsuccessfully served. Mr. Petrowski, do you have the documentation? No. Okay. Now, it was a pretty tight schedule. Do you have it? Well, I'm going to give you the option. Do you want to go ahead and litigate without knowing, or do you want to can this? Hmm. Well, I would have pulled it because I had no idea. He's a lawyer, Jim. That's all. His ammunition is in that book.
And talking about the room being stacked, I mean, even just fighting a traffic ticket the other day, and I don't want to compare the two, but you kind of get the feeling, okay, the judge, the cops,
the Crown attorney,
and the Crown, even duty counsel, I mean, they're all employed by the province.
100%.
I feel like I'm here all by myself as a private citizen. And I had a, what did I have? I had a, oh, I got a speeding ticket on the way to my dad's. And then, I pulled over to call McConnell, and I didn't see the cop, and I was probably speeding. I was doing 90-something kilometers down bigger road where the speed limit's 80. And so I was going to call McConnell. So I pull over on the side of the road just before bigger road. My dad lives on the corner of Moyer and bigger road in Port Robinson. I pull over. I'm there not even 30 seconds. Cop pulls up behind me with his lights on. I'm like, the hell? I didn't even see this cop. And I had gone around some hydro trucks that were trimming trees or whatever, and I could see traffic coming. So I kind of pinned it and went around them so I could make it, you know, without causing any more trouble. So I got, and then he comes back to the car. He goes, you don't have a license. I said, I got a license right here. I said, I've been driving for 2 years. I got insurance last year with no trouble.
Right.
Like brand new insurance with a new company.
Right.
You tell me they didn't pull my abstract. They didn't find out I was on license. So at some point, my fines had disqualified me, unpaid fines.
Right.
I went and paid the fines, and they're saying I didn't go and pay this $150 registration fee to get my new license back or whatever. I've been driving for 2 years on this thing. So I take it to court, and I'm nervous. I mean, my pits are soaked because I'm out of my element. I don't do this. I'm representing myself. So, that, you know, the first they get remanded, I'm going to retain counsel. Okay. So next time I come up, the cop's not there. He had a personal compassionate day. I go like, this is my second time here, man. I'm coming from out of town. This is painful and it's costing me some money.
Wow.
I want to deal with this today. Well, the officer couldn't be here. Sorry. Okay. Next time.
What if you couldn't be there?
Well, next time I come up, I'm like, my lawyer, blah, blah, blah. Yeah. And I haven't picked, and I need more time.
No, that's different. What if you didn't show? Too bad.
Oh, yeah. You're convicted. So then I say something about, you know, my lawyer and I have to get a lawyer. And so I get smacked around by the female judge at that point. The officer's here. We're ready to go.
Right.
And what's your problem? I go, well, I'm not ready. Like, I haven't got my abstract back from blah, blah, blah.
Was your lawyer there?
No, I was representing myself.
Okay.
So this is all the same Crown. I can't remember. Vu was his name, I think. Young guy, good looking guy. Okay. I come in, I'm like, he's like, no. He thumbs through all my stuff. He goes, look at this driving record. No, we're going to seek a $400 fine. I said, a $400 fine? What, for an administrative error? I paid all my fines. I've been to the courthouse.
He was the Crown?
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, and he wouldn't budge.
Wow.
I'm like, dude, drop this one. I'll plead guilty to the speeding. Nope. I'm going for a $400 fine on this
one. Wow. Thing.
I'm like, dude.
What court was this?
This is Niagara Falls.
Wow.
On Queen Street. Next time I come back, I got a new good-looking young Crown. A guy. And they're both guys.
Representing the same cop?
The Crown or prosecutor, same people in traffic court, I think. So this guy walks over, big strapping guy walks over. Mr. Fannon, yeah. He goes, I don't think the cop was there again. If I had proceeded with it, they probably would have thrown everything out.
Right.
And he says to me, he says, okay, yeah, we're going to drop this, and you plead guilty to this. Full fine, no reduction, no bullshit, you know, no negotiation. I'm like, what are we waiting for? Let's do this. So they dropped the driving without a license, which was really an administrative thing because my fines had been paid off for years. I just didn't, I swear I went and got the reinstatement. Right. That's what they call it, $150 reinstatement fee.
Right.
So finally, but I know what it feels like. And that's what, when you go into a courtroom, you feel like everyone is on the dole. Are on the payroll of the Liberal government, whoever's in power. It's part of the province. They're state employees type of thing. So then when you bring up this whole integrity commissioner thing and, you know, the fact that you're 24/7, it doesn't matter if you're up north in a boat fishing. I know you like to use that analogy, or your Twitter account. Bullshit, man. I will not stand for anyone that's going Jehovah Witness, Christian, or whatever, when they go handing out pamphlets door to door, that they are breaking a code.
Correct.
At the region.
Thank you.
And so the code of conduct, when this whole thing came up, I'm like, you can't have a code of conduct that breaks the Charter of Rights.
Well, that should be out of the gate.
Plain and simple.
When you said,
I'm going to challenge the code, Jim, against the charter,
right.
I'm like, go.
Right.
Because every code in Ontario is corrupt. And every integrity commissioner has suspended jurisprudence to do exactly to you what they're doing with everyone
Amen.
Else out there.
Amen.
And next time it's going to be a different guy. And they're going to say, what? An anonymous complaint? I don't know what the complaint is. I can't speak to it. It's not going to be tried fairly.
There's no evidence. Who's the complainant?
I mean, we saw this Swayze guy. You recorded the damn interview. The guy was, come on. You know you're guilty, Andy. Right. Like, how many times did he say, you know, this is, and I've already met, and I don't need to talk to these people. Right. Like, I think it's still on SoundCloud.
And they're here's what's funny.
That was the most ridiculous interview ever.
Him and Mascarin, and thankfully George Rostai, who saw through this jurisdictional issue and said, Andy, you're not guilty of this code of conduct complaint because you were at a golf tournament as a friend in your private capacity. And I'm not even sure what you're accused of. I don't buy that because there weren't enough witnesses on either side. But I'm not going to step there because you're out of your capacity. So I was out of my capacity on Twitter. I'm out of my capacity at the Pelham Town Council. And
Sandy's out of capacity driving to 1010 to do the weekly talk show with, what's his name?
I was out of capacity. And at the same time, some of the hypocritical members of council saying, but you're in capacity when we're going to assess you your expenses. So you can't have it both ways. And the way to get around all this is to, I would say, coming back full circle to the governance thing, is take a look at how we govern ourselves. Get rid of the mayors on council, have full-time counselors, whether it's still the same 18. You don't need to replace the other 12, Jim, because it's not like you're going to miss them.
Who cares?
But rep by pop. I don't even think you need counselors by the municipality. Get rid of the parochialism. Cut the region up into 8 wards, north-south line, and then 8 wards, or 12, whatever you want. I'm fine with the nonsense. You want to add more in so it's not centralized, but have it rep by pop. 3 counselors for every ward. So 3
doesn't,
times 8.
Doesn't
3
the
times
parochialism
8?
Come in with the wards, though?
Well, I guess. Hmm. I guess, but you can't make it too prohibitive to run. So,
right.
But the wards can touch other municipalities. So at least you're part of St. Catharines, Thor. Let's say if you're on the west side or east side, you're St. Catharines, Niagara, and the lake, and and the south or north part of Niagara Falls. But anyway, the current system isn't working. It's
yeah,
not.
And
Jim,
you and I aren't going to come up with the perfect
system. But
Jim,
it's not working.
I think you're right as far as getting the mayors off there, because that is a total my backyard. They're there for nothing but their backyard.
Well, they're there. Listen, they get reelected by what they do for the city. So what are they doing at the region that I wouldn't do if I wasn't a mayor? Get for my city.
Get for the city.
Yeah. And when you get for the city out of the region's tax pocket, it's still the same taxpayer. Still comes out of my dad's pocket. My dad's now, of course, because still comes out of our parents' taxes and our taxes, okay? But it comes off the budget at the region. So the mayors have their own city budgets. Well, they don't want to see the St. Catharines budget go from 100 to 110. If the mayor, God bless him, can get a $10 million project from the region, Jim, spread out across the region, right? Mm-hmm. He's still getting the project done, but it's not affecting his budget. Mm-hmm. So isn't that funny? The taxes at the region, this is true. The taxes at the region, don't tell them this. So this, don't make sure they don't listen to this part. They could bust the taxes up at the region 10% more, like on $350 million, another, add a $50 million, use that entire $50 million, Jim, for their city's benefits, right? All those mayors can go together. And besides, they do go together. They have mayor's meetings, Jim. We don't have 18. If we had 18, we'd already be quorum, right? Because 30 councillors, half of 30 is 15. We'd be at quorum if we had 18. They're at 12.
So they're three away from the majority.
And the ombudsman's saying that's okay. But they can still have meetings, Jim, that discuss specifically how they're going to vote about regional issues.
And that's not considered a meeting outside
no.
of council.
And it's you scratch my back, I scratch yours. So I'm
well,
sure.
Well, we saw that with the airports, right?
The airports is the best example. Oh, yeah. Yeah, that blackmail that we had to take that grass patch up there in Pelham that Mayor Augustine gets up when I say grass patch. Well, that's what it is. There's not one municipality at upper tier in Ontario or probably the universe that owns something that kind of, let's just say, grass patch, you know, it is. No, but nobody owns such a small airport like that at the upper tier level. Even Jim, I don't want to take over this one. I don't want to take over this one. Let the cities run it. Let it go broke and let the private
sector.
Who's
on it now? Is this
Niagara Falls?
Niagara Lake and St. Catharines?
Yeah, and Thorold opted out because they don't want to pay the head tax. So
St. Catharines, Niagara Falls, Niagara Lake?
Correct. And they can't afford it. So they're trying to dump it on the region, get the region to pay for it. So the South mayors say, well, we don't want to participate in that unless you take our millstone around our neck called Pelham Airport or whatever it's called, the Dorothy Stratton Airport or whomever. I'm sorry, I don't remember because it's really not something that...
Grass patch.
Right. And you take ours. That's an example. You take ours, we'll take yours, and then we'll sink millions into it. And the plan is sink millions in from the region taxpayer, upgrade it, and then maybe, and then nothing will happen because I can't believe that airline going back and forth to Toronto is financially very viable. There's a plane service there. We never hear about that. Right. By the way, if it disappeared, we'll never have anyone come forward and say, oh, by the way.
I take that three times a week.
Pardon me?
Well, you're not going to have everyone stand up and say it. That's what.
No, but if it disappeared, I don't know if it has. So if you're still in business, God bless you, because nothing seems to work across the lake, ferries, planes, whatever, hydrofoils. The point is this. It's dump money in. And, of course, all the local contractors will benefit very handsomely from all the upgrades. Good. Make work projects for all of them and their employees on the taxpayers' back, and then nothing will work because we'll just have beautiful, empty plazas of airports, and then what are we going to do? Sell it to somebody maybe for a dollar. What's Collingwood doing right now? The Clearview Airport? They want to get rid of it. They've admitted we can't take care of it. It's on the market. Just put this airport, if these mayors really can't afford it, and I can see they can't afford it. It's not viable. There's not enough traffic.
Well, they can't sell it either. So they want to find a sucker like the region to buy it.
No, but then sell it to somebody for a buck. Give the private sector a chance to make something with it.
Oh, to get out of the business.
To get out of the business. And there's money in the fuel. There's money in the hangars. Maybe somebody can minimally, Jim, keep the pulse going through that. Like, you won't be closing it. Maybe somebody can run it, at least run it with a bottom line perspective. If the region takes it over, it's going to become a money pit. And it already was, because before I got there in 2010, the region put 3 or 4 of $12 million into that of a one-third. The four cities, or the three cities, Jim, didn't even put up the $4 million in the, when I say one-third, I mean the feds one-third, province one-third,
And the cities come to the region in 2008, 6 to 10 and go, will you replace us as the third? The region paid a third for an airport. They have absolutely no, you talk about governance? Where was the governance connection between the region and that airport? Those 4 municipalities, where was it, Jim? Didn't exist. Where did they even have the legal right to write a check for $4 million? Where? But who asked those questions? So I'm against it because I think I'm not against an airport if it can be financially viable. I'm not against anything. Hey, if we can somehow wave a magic wand and Niagara becomes a place the entire world wants to descend to and visit and everything else, Niagara Falls and wine country, I'm all for that. But Jim, I'll tell you something. I don't trust what the people who want to do this really want to achieve, and I darn well know it's going to cost millions and millions and millions of dollars. And I say openly, I don't trust, and then I'll have other counselors go, does that mean you don't trust me? You wear it how you want to, Mr. or Mrs. You wear it how you want to. I do not trust. And that is what my job is. My job is not to get along with staff. Be respectful, sure. But I'm allowed to challenge, and I'm allowed to debate. They can't stand it. It's like, why are you browbeating staff? As soon as you ask a question, why are the tanks leaking in Niagara on the Lake? Brand new sewage treatment plant, which we haven't taken over yet. I'm browbeating. So how do we deal with the browbeater, Jim? Throw a code of conduct complaint in against it. But that's the game.
Well, yeah, but I guess everyone can play that game, right?
No. No, we don't play it.
Well, the town of Pelham.
No, but you know what, Jim, the right doesn't. If we want to talk right, left, the right doesn't. Name me, you know, Councillor Hyten, Councillor Edgar had complaints against them, dismissed. That was a private citizen, wasn't with internally, because we found out that Councillor Augustine got up and said, I will name who one of the code of conduct complainants is against Mr. Petrowski or Councillor Petrowski, and revealed it was the town of Pelham.
Which isn't a legitimate
person.
Yeah, you have to be a person.
Well, no, they would argue a corporation. In the corporation, the town of Pelham is a person. Nonsense. Hey, if it means attacking, the left will make it work. And they did. And they got away with it. And it was atrocious what they got away with this code of conduct fiasco. And it'll be atrocious again now that they're doing it under review. Although I have to say this, also newsflash, I've heard that the current integrity commissioner, which is now the full-time one, because Mascarin was part-time,
right.
I have heard they looked back and saw how Mascarin did their work. I've heard, and I don't care who asked me because I'm not telling you, I've heard that they weren't impressed, and I'm being very polite. It was a complete fiasco. Complete. It was a complete corrupt process. The notion that anybody could get away with that integrity commissioner. But even worse too, Jim, is what your elected officials supported by ratifying the recommendations in that code of conduct complaint. Because they should have all been thrown out. Number one, under charter, freedom of expression, whether it's good expression or not, or as some radio people say, but it's not consequence-free freedom of speech. But anyway,
I don't think anyone expects their freedom, their free speech, to be consequence-free. I
don't either, but the only consequence, if it's not illegal. Jim, did I break any laws? Did my tweets break a law? Yes or no?
No.
Did my calling the mayor at town of Pelham disruptive break the law?
I got to agree with you on that.
But Jim, if you don't break the law,
then
why do you have a code of conduct? So you don't need a code. You have a code to punish people politically. Bart May said it once. He said it many times.
How do you decide what's disrespectful or what's unbecoming of a counselor?
But I will tell you how. I'll tell you how.
Foul language?
I'll tell you how, Jim. You can have a complaint process, and you can say, I'm complaining, and I want an apology, and then the counselor has the right to say yes or no. And that can be public in the paper, and that can be shaming on its own.
Mm-hmm.
And it should end there because it's lawful. But guess what that accomplishes, especially after the standard pumping for a guy like one reporter, not a reporter, hack journalist,
columnist,
coming after me, religious persecution, going to keep getting that out. You do have a final outcome. You know what the outcome's called? The ballot box. There's your consequence-free freedom of speech. If people don't like what I said, and it should get publicized. There's no problem with it getting publicized. But my tweets have been on there like for 6-9 months. And then all of a sudden, do you know the notion of passing a motion to say, we want to hire an integrity commissioner? And you know what they did the same night in December last year? Oh, but we're going to backdate
all potential complaint opportunities to a year and a half before this so we can catch Andy. I call it catch Andy on anything he did before. And that passing. We're in the Municipal Act. Can you go retroactive? So, Jim, no. I'm going to do this. This budget year, you're a real estate guy, and you'll admit people from out of town think our taxes are horrendous compared to Toronto, right?
Amen.
Right?
Yeah,
horrendous.
Toronto guys come down here, and they're like, they can't even believe our taxes.
2 to 3 times what they pay. Okay, so you know what I'm going to do? At budget, I'm going to say, let's make retroactive a 3% increase since the beginning of this term. I'm going to make it retroactive. So let's go back. We missed our opportunity in 11. Let's go back 3%. Not 11. We're now 14, 18. In 15 and in 16 and 17, let's do retroactive. Can you imagine passing a retroactive tax bill?
Well, that's why they don't let you do retroactive motions.
They're against the law. They're against the law. But this council passed a retroactive motion. And they know it. But hey, if I stood up.
You might be giving up too much credit by saying they know it because they don't know the Municipal Act that well.
No,
there's probably
I know.
A handful. No, of those
but
some
there that are a few that yeah. do. The Mayor Pelham certainly probably knows. Mm. And here's the thing, though, with the code of conduct attack on my freedom of speech, and these illegal motions, they want me to spend my money to uphold the law. Wrong. I shouldn't have to uphold the charter. If they don't like what I say, they should codify in the code, Jim, Andy, councillors can't say this word, this word, this word, this word. Right now, and you read Mascarin's code of conduct, he says, and he should acknowledge on his Twitter that it's not appropriate for this type of language. What type? What?
Well, am I breaking the law? Am I engaging in hate
speech? No, but why not give me the list of 4,500 words I can't use? Hmm. Can't use words like scaly. Can't use words like plastic. No, but honestly, Jim, the point is this. In the States, the politicians don't have to go in front of a court system and cost taxpayers money to uphold the charter on behalf of, it's not just me. By going in front of the court system, challenging this legally, getting legal advice that, by the way, to take the council now to court would probably cost 2 to 3 times that, right? But that would be a benefit to all the public for two reasons. Number one, you get rid of this illegal notion that you don't have the right to disagree. Because at the end of the day, Jim, freedom of speech, when it's legal and not, so it's not inciting hatred or violence, right? That's illegal.
Right.
You and I can disagree, we do all day long. But you, what's that old saying from Voltaire? I may disagree with what you say, but not your right to say it.
Yeah, defend your right to say it.
Okay, that's all right. So at the end of the day, we have to fight for that, because if we don't, we have nothing. And we can say, and I'm glorifying it, but I had a father and an uncle who served in the war. People fought way before us for these liberties and these rights. Okay, they did. They did. Now we're glossing this over because of political correctness. So number one, we have to fight for that. But the second thing is, who wants to run, Jim? You had a political. Who wants to run
with the threat that Nimrod can just file a complaint against you at any time?
Correct. And you will never know what you can. You will never know what conduct you're entitled to until the council of the day says, through their integrity commissioner, cough, cough, what you can and can't say. In the States, when a politician, when Jim Fannon counselor, any Petrowski counselor says something and someone thinks you broke the First Amendment, same thing, First Amendment, freedom of speech, okay? Like our charter, Section 2, freedom of speech. In the States, you take Andy to court to say he violated the First Amendment. It's not for Andy to go to court to say, uphold my First Amendment, my charter. They're forcing me to uphold my charter rights.
So is this where the 44,000 comes in?
Yes.
And so how do you justify flipping that on the region as far as, an offensive move?
To understand what my legal options are to fight this. And at the end of the day, Jim, to fight it, and I said, it's going to take, So I now, with this new expense policy, Bart Mays fought to leave it in. They said, no, you can't have legal expenses. So anybody can attack Andy, even frivolously. And I would say those complaints, we're not talking about right or wrong language. I apologize for wrong, but they weren't illegal. I didn't break any laws. So anyone who attacks Andy, who has stayed within the law but has broken a subjective code of conduct, has no legal recourse, has no legal costs, has no legal defense. You're on your own. And let me tell you something, Jim, because I tried to defend myself, and I did, successfully last term. It's hours and hours and hours of putting together your case against a frivolous, malicious, political code of conduct complaint, completely grounded in a hit job and a witch hunt. So Andy, part-time Andy, making his $25,000 a year as a regional counselor, because I'm exposing all these deeds at the end of the day or challenging staff, and some counselors don't like it and are using
this. Or just
this,
asking questions.
Just asking questions. Because these some counselors or members of the public who are in bed with those counselors want to come after me because I'm rocking the boat called status quo. So we have a thing. We now have a thing. We can go after Andy. We have a way to take him off the rails forever and constantly. The code of conduct. Because Andy can't hire a lawyer to defend himself. So we will swamp him. And as long as we get a liberal-friendly integrity commissioner, which the last one clearly was, and as long as we get a guy who will throw, and isn't this funny, as a lawyer, he's all day, he's in a court representing his clients, and he has to adhere to the principles of natural justice, know your complaint. Like, does anyone ever go into a courthouse, Jim, and the table beside you is empty? The defendant or the plaintiff? You always know? Do you see your plaintiff? Yep. Does the judge say, this is what you're charged of, Mr. Mm-hmm. Fannon? And by the way, after their side, do you get to present your side before the judge or jury picks it? Oh, in this case, you don't know who you are. You don't know what you're charged with. You don't get a chance to present your case. And by the way, Andy, and other counselors, and other Jim Fannons who may want to run in Niagara, you're on your own now.
So how's this going to change then with a new integrity commissioner with a so-called new code of conduct? How's anything?
Well, there's a bunch of counselors. No, they're fighting hard. Some of them, Tony Quirk, and I think Councillor Valpatti brought forward a motion to try to capture this term of official capacity that, yes, Jim, I agree. When I'm there at council or when I'm doing region business at the region, or I'm representing the region.
Out in the field.
Which, by the way, is exactly how Brock structures their student code of conduct. Go and look at it. It's online. It says you are a student when you're on campus. Period.
Right, okay.
When you're on campus.
Or an official capacity.
Or an official capacity. So if you're on campus.
Which is pretty clear. I'm here representing Brock. I'm here representing the region.
And that's, I guess that means if you're at that bar at the back. What was there a bar used to be called? Isaac's. There was one actually on the edge. There was the escarpment when I was a little kid, because we used to climb up the escarpment, hear the rock and roll and everything. But anyway, that means you're on property. You're in official capacity, right? You're under our rules. Makes sense? Sure. Makes sense.
Okay.
Even after hours. I mean, hey, you're in the cafeteria. We expect you to behave according to the code of conduct of students here. Like, you know, don't throw your pudding cup at somebody or whatever. But the region, because they can get away with it, and because there's liberals in the media, even I hear on the radio going, I think they're on the clock 24/7. Ridiculous. Nonsense. And if they are, then pay me to be on the clock 24/7. My dad was a doctor. He wasn't on the clock 24/7.
Is there no precedent that's ever been set this before? Like, no, this is capacity.
No,
this is not.
There are codes of conduct in the province that specify capacity, and I think Councillor Quirk and Councillor Valpatti pointed to it, so they do. But cowardly Liberal government Kathleen Wynne and company, when they just did the amendments, Jim, to the Municipal Act.
Didn't touch anything like that.
No. You can have a code of conduct in Belleville and a code of conduct in Atikokan, and one can make you accountable 24/7. The other can make you accountable just when you're in the counselor chamber, for that matter, at two extremes. She has allowed the code of conduct to be... Jim, it's a Wild West. So what should have happened? Simple.
One code of conduct
across the province.
Three integrity commissioners employed by the province.
Amen.
To come in and, but
amen.
Then won't they be employed by the Wynne or the ruling government of the day too?
Apparently, but at least you have, you know, I have some faith in the appeal court system. The appeal, take it out of the local judges here, which are all reading the newspapers.
They're
all
reading the papers. So when the decision comes down, you have recourse to appeal it.
And then you have recourse to appeal it. You can take it higher. And by the way, if you take it higher, you should have an opportunity to have your costs paid for. And you know what? It sucks that maybe the taxpayer has to. But Jim, cops here in Niagara who are accused of confused of all sorts of things, suspended with pay, and who pays for the legal fees?
Us.
We do. Mm-hmm. And even when they get found guilty, who gets paid with the legal fees mm-hmm. at the end? And when they go back to their job, who pays for their compensation? Why are they much different? Why? Well, because, you know, they're public servants, you know, they're employees or whatever. Fine.
Who's going to say no to the cops?
Pardon?
Who's going to say no to the cops?
No, firemen have the same. But same, Jim, for any public sector worker at the region.
$100 million. Is that what we?
What?
Is that our?
140.
Okay, St. Catharines portion of the NRP budget is $100 million. Is
no,
that right?
St. Catharines total municipal budget is about probably. I'm suggesting it probably pushing 110. So it's at 100-ish, and of the 100, one third, $30 million, okay. $35 million goes to the police. And another $25 million, get this,
half
to fire, budget. 25 and 35? No, that's 60. 60% of the budget is for two professions, important professions, and then throw on ambulance.
When's the last time we had a fire?
Don't go there with me, Jim.
These guys are paying $100,000 a year to shine trucks and sleep on their backs. No offense to the firemen, but seriously.
You're talking about night shift.
Can we go back to the volunteer firemen days? Well, there's still communities around Canada that have volunteer firemen, don't they?
Communities? Right here in Niagara. Ask Mayor Bob Bentley what would happen to his budget if he had to pull his 95% to 100% volunteer fire department and replace them with union. Or Welland. Jim, they'd go broke tomorrow. They have volunteer fire departments. Now, I'm not weighing in right, wrong, volunteer or not, but the thing is this. How do you have two sets of rules? How come volunteer firefighters is okay in Welland and Grimsby? Grimsby, come on. Let's say this. Built out to the urban boundary, houses everywhere. They are I would suggest a developed and mature urban community today, right? Mm-hmm. They're not the old, we're kind of in the same time era when we were here. They're not the old rural Grimsby anymore, right? They have the escarpment. They are a mature and developed urban. They have an almost all volunteer fire department. So they're running, Jim, a budget without the cost that St. Catharines covers of a basically 25% of their budget. So if you take, I don't know what Grimsby's budget is, but let's say Grimsby's budget is 30, 40 million. And they're paying some volunteer, you know, they pay stipends and all that. You throw on fire, it jumps to $55, $60 million. And they know that. Fire, like full time. All shifts, 24 hours. So I guess, well, firemen are 24 hours. Maybe that's why counselors are 24 hours. Let's leave on that note for now.
Thanks for your time, brother.
Thank you.
Appreciate it. I don't know if we solved anything today, but it's always good to talk to somebody that doesn't.
Well, I'm sure we've given the press a lot of food for fodder.
Yeah.
Like I said, my little byline, just because I'm being interviewed and Jim sharing his opinions doesn't mean I automatically agree
with him. The opinions of this guest and the sponsors are not necessarily, although they may be, the opinions of the sponsors and guests.
But they're all apparently fair game for the next code of conduct volley.
Yeah, right? Amen.
So...
All right, brother.
Thank you, Jim. Over.